of the Cape Elizabeth Town Council for the century.
It was kind of an awesome thought as I was driving in here, parking in the no parking zone out back here. And we here in the town council, and I know I speak for everybody here, are honored to be able to serve the citizens of Cape Elizabeth. We're duly elected by the people, and we ran for the office, and now it's our duty and our enjoyment, actually, to do what we do here. This is a pretty good council. We seem to work well together. We haven't been all together that long, but we work well together. We seem to have some healthy debates, which is the way it goes forward. And we seem to be able to be making a lot of progress. There's some wonderful things happening to our town. We're very fortunate to be serving in a community where we have all of you out here in the audience, including our students, who volunteer and participate in our community in a variety of ways. We're very lucky. We in the council look forward to serving in the next century, to continue our service to the town, and we look forward to having you all here again. With that, we will get on with the Pledge of Allegiance. I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Yeah, we'll do the roll call. We also have our one student representative now who maybe one day can say to his children, do you know where I was? I was serving our town when we changed. We need the roll call, please.
Chairman Carson.
Here.
Councilor Barry.
Here.
Councilor Fritz.
Here.
Councilor Watson.
Here.
Councilor McGinty.
Here.
Councilor Roberts.
Here.
Councilor Swift-Kayata.
Here.
Representative Bolas and Representative Rowe.
Thank you. And the next item is one of the more enjoyable items that I get to do. I'll start here. I'm going to come down front, make presentations to the students. Old former school teachers like to do this sort of thing. This is a presentation from the town of Cape Elizabeth. It is a town council proclamation for the Cape Elizabeth Boys Golf. Whereas the Cape Elizabeth Boys Golf Team recently earned the Maine State Golf Championship, whereas this achievement was accomplished as the result of much practice and dedication to the sport of golf, and whereas the team won the final match against some of the best golfers in all of Maine, and whereas the entire Cape Elizabeth community is proud of the accomplishments of the members of this team, now, therefore, be it resolved by the Cape Elizabeth Town Council that we hereby congratulate the Cape Elizabeth Boys Golf State Champions, and we praise them for the honor they have earned for themselves, their families, for their school, and for their community. Dated this 13th day of December 1999 at Cape Elizabeth, Maine. And I, for one, only hope to have a handicap like those kids have. Yes, who is going to come up and receive this?
But all of them.
All of you going to come up here? We have a photographer. One of the things that might be nice is to have each of these people, young people, say their name for the people at home, that this is the state golf champion team.
Tim Irvin.
Andy Rowe.
Troy Hanna.
Rob Benoit.
Mike D'Angelo.
Jason Emery.
Calvin Rank.
I recognize some of those names. I think it's an inherited characteristic here.
We also have a couple members who aren't able to be here tonight. We have Alyssa Hayes, who's not able to be here, Mike Rotenberg, Tom Rowe, Jeff Doughty, and Sam Mawinney.
Thank you very much. And who's going to receive this? All of you. You right here. Thank you very much on behalf of the town of Cape Elizabeth and the school. From the town of Cape Elizabeth, Town Council Proclamation, Cape Elizabeth Girls Soccer, State Class A Champions. Whereas the Cape Elizabeth Girls Soccer Team recently earned the Maine State Soccer Championship, And whereas this achievement was accomplished as the result of much practice and dedication throughout their 16-1-1 season, and whereas the team won the final game in a thrilling double overtime game, and whereas the entire Capeless community is proud of the accomplishments of the members of this team, now therefore be it resolved by the Cape Elizabeth Town Council that we hereby congratulate the Cape Elizabeth Girls Soccer Champions, and we praise them for the honor they have earned for themselves, their families, for their school, and for the community, dated this 13th day of December, 1999. Congratulations. Please come forward. I think it would be good if you also introduced yourself to the audience at home.
I'm Allison Cunningham.
Leslie Willis.
Monica Bergman.
Lauren Schumann.
Carla Bergman.
Allison McGinnis.
Shannon Bailey.
Jasmine Brown.
Is there anybody missing?
Oh, yeah.
Could you, well, there's a whole team missing, but are there, oh, well, maybe it's too many names for you to come up with. Well, at any rate, we in Cape Elizabeth are very proud, and we congratulate you. And this is something that I really remember. My daughter was one of the first girls when we had a girls' soccer team. And I think that he might remember that the girls played in junior high school. First, the boys played a quarter, and they had to let the girls play the quarter in the middle. It was horrible for them. They hated it all the time. That was the only girls' soccer team that we had at the time. But anyway, congratulations, and thank you very much from the town. It was a great season. Congratulations to Charlie, too. His dream to become a coach brings him right to the state champion. All right. Reports and correspondence.
Madam Chairman, I guess I have a report from the Historic Preservation Study Committee. Our committee has been working on a possible ordinance draft. We've spent most of a year in meetings. Our committee has had three different public forums, and I think that's a record for any community in the committee in the town. One of the hardest things I think to draft is an ordinance or a statute for the legislature. It's very difficult to think of everything. And in the most recent public forum, which we had on December 8th, it seemed to be the consensus of the good turnout of the community, of the members of the town, that they need more time. And accordingly, I'm going to make a motion to suspend the rules because we didn't have a chance to get this on the agenda for tonight's meeting. But if it pleases the council, I'd like to make a motion to suspend the rules to take up an item out of sequence on the agenda. And that motion will be to extend the time for the Historic Preservation Committee to provide a longer period of time for this committee to work with the community in seeing if the people want to have a historic preservation ordinance of some sort.
Well, we have two things. First, we have to vote on suspending the rules. I don't see right. The item on the, do we know what the number was of the early?
You'd just add the, add
yeah,
it as the last
you'd just
item.
Add it as,
it would
as
be item 66. Number 66.
We'll add it as a 66, and then we'll take it up. First, we'll vote on taking it up out of order.
I make the motion to take, to suspend the rules.
Thank Second. You. Been moved and seconded. Is there any further discussion? All those in favor? Okay, Henry, now your motion.
The motion is the result of the vote of the committee, who, after attending the forum the other night with the folks, felt that they would like to, well, they made a motion which was carried to extend the time to June 1st in the year 2000 for the committee to submit their recommendations to the town council. In its present form, the charge from the council to the committee is to return a report back by the end of this month, which would be December 31st. And so what our request is, and what my motion is to extend the time for sending a report back to the town council until June 1st, 2000. which is a date, our planner felt would give us more time to communicate with the community, work on an ordinance, and get input from the people.
Thank you. Is there a second to that motion?
Second.
Now discussion.
I first of all, I want to commend Councilor Berry and Councilor Fritz and everybody else on the committee, because I think they did a really good job. I've attended all the public meetings, the public forum meetings, and they've been very informative. I learned a lot, and it's really obvious that the committee has labored very long and hard on this issue, which is of great importance to the town. It was apparent, as Henry said, that at the last meeting, about 75% of the citizens who spoke, and probably about three-quarters of the people who stood during the meeting to indicate their views, were very concerned and, I guess you could say, against the ordinance as drafted, the proposed ordinance. I think it would be a good idea to extend the time of the committee, but I am somewhat concerned that if we extend it to June 1st, there's about 200 homes on this list, mostly people's private residences, that the owners of these homes are sort of hanging, wondering what's happening. And I would be in favor of extending the time for the committee, but perhaps not quite so long, perhaps to March. I was thinking March 1st, but I'm open. I want to hear further discussion from councilors on this, but I would like to see the purpose of allowing the committee to focus on exploring voluntary programs for encouraging historic preservation in Cape Elizabeth. I am not in favor of mandatory programs, and I would like to propose not giving quite so much time so that people are on the list are not left hanging for so long, wondering what is going to happen with their property.
Madam Chairman, through the chair, I can appreciate that sentiment, and I think that that's an acceptable idea to the members of the community, except perhaps one more month till April 1st might give us more time for a public forum again to get the input from the people. And also, we'd like to have a joint workshop with the council, with the committee and the council, as early as possible, perhaps in January, in order that we might get a better sense of direction in the charge from the council to our committee, in order that we might act along, give us a track for our choo-choo to run on here, and give us some direction. And with that,
I could go for April 1st.
I would accept that amendment to my motion, certainly.
Okay. Second it.
We're going to have more discussion, but you are going to change your motion. I have to see the seconder to April 1st.
If that is a motion to change it, then perhaps we should have some discussion.
We need
on
to
that.
Second it, and then we need to discuss whether.
I seconded it.
Okay, Carol.
If I might just comment that I think there's a lot of interest on the committee to explore voluntary kind of measures, but that sort of thing takes time. I mean, if you say to only March, that's really only three meetings. That's not a lot of time to do some exploring. And the other reason that I think 6 months is a good time frame is that gives us time to find out what the legislature will do with the amendment that was just passed in November, and find out what their direction will be for towns, so that the committee can have a recommendation to give the council concerning that.
I hear what you're saying, and I think that's important. As far as the time for the committee has worked very hard on it, I know, but I think, unfortunately for the committee, there's more hard work yet to be done. I would just reiterate, I'm concerned about the people who are on the list who have been sort of wondering what's going to happen with their homes for 6-9 months now, almost a year. And to have them wonder for another 6 months seems like a long time to me.
Again, if I might just comment, that list is really only a draft. the real list that's in effect is what's in our ordinances at this time, and that list certainly hasn't even, we just had our consultants provide the list just a couple months ago. It hasn't been a long-term kind of situation.
I understand that they're not formally on any list attached to any ordinance, but they are concerned because they are on a sort of proposed list the consultants come up with.
Madam Chair?
Yes.
It's seldom that I'm a fence sitter on any issue. I'm usually either, I'm pretty decisive one way or the other. But this one, I really am a fence sitter. On the one hand, I would like to see some historic preservation. On the other hand, I believe strongly in personal property rights. I would like to give this committee as much time as they deem necessary to sort it all out and bring, you know, an acceptable product to us that we can act on. And in response to Ann's comment about these people wondering where they sit, they're currently under the current ordinance, which essentially says all they have to do is give 45 days notice and basically do what they want. So for those people, it's not as though they're waiting to see if they can do something with their property. They can do pretty much what they want right now as long as they give the 45 days notice. And so I don't think they're really held in limbo in any particular way. And I also agree with what Carol said about seeing how this tax incentive might shake out and how it may have some impact on how we formulate our ordinance here.
As I understand, and perhaps I've misunderstood, but the current list of the people who are on the 45-day list is a smaller list than the list of people I'm talking about, who is the bigger group of people who may be affected.
I would say that they're not affected at all then.
No, I'm saying they may be affected, and that's what they're worried about. That's why all those people have turned out for the public meetings. I'm not saying that they have any legal restrictions on what they can do with their property right now. I'm just saying if I were on this list, I'd be feeling sort of nervous about what was going on, not because the committee is doing anything wrong or bad. I think historic preservation is great. I'm all for it. It's one reason I moved to Cape Elizabeth, because it's a wonderful place to live and it has so many beautiful structures in town. But I am just concerned that the people who are on the proposed list, the 200-odd people who are on that list, may be quite concerned. And I felt they gave a very strong voice at the last couple of meetings about what they felt should or should not happen with an ordinance. And I'd find it painful if I were on the list to be wondering for another 6 months. That's my only point. I'm not trying to constrain the committee. I think they've done a good job so far, but I would like to see them have a little bit tighter time frame. But I'd be interested in hearing what other councilors have to say.
Well, we're still in the discussion phase, and I think we should go back to discussing exactly the first motion that was put forward by Henry, which we'll need to then vote on before we see if he wants to change, since there's discussion available here. Is there any more discussion on these dates? And this is something I don't have a particular opinion on. I don't want to squeeze the committee so that during the holidays and then they got to rush back and they have these three meetings. I do think three is not enough to deal with the issue, but
that's what
I don't
the
know
committee
where it should
felt,
be.
Madam Chairman, that we are going to have a workshop with the council, which won't be until next month, and then the clock is running on our committee time, even if we do get an extension.
And so you want to have a workshop with the council.
Right.
You want to have a couple of meetings with the committee, then to decide what, and then you want to have also another public forum.
I'd like to have that, you know.
It's easily 4 months to me, at least.
Madam Chair, I would suggest we look at May 1st. I mean, that gives us, it's 1 month more than April, a month short of June, but it allows for five meetings, one with the council, two or three amongst yourself, and then one more month really to put a report together, okay, which takes some time.
On a point of order here, I believe there is a motion that's been seconded for April 1st.
No.
No.
There's June. April 1st.
June.
April.
He amended.
Oh, you March 1st? No, I made
amended
a motion.
You made a motion for June.
And then there was a motion to amend that.
That's right. And you, the motioner, agreed to that, but
well, it wasn't
you That was my fault. I should have allowed the vote to go forward on the first motion. I thought we could shorten the process here.
I'm doing my best to work with you.
But we have more discussion here.
I mean, this is a short session of the legislature, but they're likely not to finish before May. Mm-hmm. So then that wouldn't give the committee time to consider anything if you don't at least go to June. So I would implore that the committee have that amount of time. I mean, I really feel that at the forum, even though there were people who were speaking against the draft that the committee has put forth, I don't think that people wanted the idea of historic preservation to be ditched. I think that they wanted very careful consideration of some other alternatives, and I just hope that you'll give the committee what it needs in terms of time. They've only been working for a year, and we've had three public forums and considerable work.
Jack.
Madam Chairman, there seems to be a couple of issues here. One is to let the people know that are on that list that the voluntary type of a program will not be in place. So maybe either tonight or at the next meeting, the council could even have a vote on doing something on a mandatory basis. Either say yes, we'll proceed in that fashion, or kill the idea outright, and then proceed with the voluntary advisory type of things that what I was hearing on Wednesday night is where people want to go, and do it that way. That would take off that onus of having big government telling you what you can do with your house, and still keep open the concept and the idea of the historical preservation with an advisory type of a board or and voluntary type of suggestions. So that doesn't have to be an amendment now, but it is an area that we could perhaps go down the road to clear up one thing and keep the other process going. And that way you'd be able to give them additional time without having people worrying about some kind of a mandatory program being put on them.
Well, let me get something straight here. There can't be any mandatory program just applied to people because their names are on a list without some process going through first. So I don't think people need to worry about that their houses are suddenly going to appear in a list that they didn't know anything about. So that the list that you're presently working with is a small list that falls under the ordinance and has not yet been expanded to the big list.
That's right.
Is that correct?
Yes, that's right.
The big list is yet to have, okay.
Right.
So
I would move the question on the motion to amend.
Good idea.
Okay. That's it.
Could we have a repeat?
Thank you.
What the motion is?
The motion on the floor is that we. The motion is that. Want to read the motion?
Vote on the amendment first.
We're actually going to be voting on an amendment to the main motion for an April 1st deadline. If that fails, you go back to your main motion of June 1.
Okay. That being said, we are now voting on the amendment to the main motion of April 1st. All those in favor? Opposed? All right. We are now we are going to move to the main motion. All those in favor?
The main motion was June 1st.
Okay. Yes.
I'm sorry.
Okay. Opposed. Fine. I hadn't really planned on that item taking this amount of time when I started this evening. Thank you very much. And I know it's been a lot of hard work. And I heard some great comments, Henry, about keeping that meeting moving and keeping it together and giving everybody their opportunities.
Up in Quebec, they say, on fait ce qu'on peut. One does what one can.
Yes, well, you did what you could. I appreciate it.
And Madam Chairwoman, yes. If I could just add, I in no way want to say that I think the committee has been doing a bad job.
Oh, no.
We appreciate that,
I have full faith they will do an excellent job, and now they'll have lots of time to do an excellent job. So, I'm very pleased with the discussion that's taken place in town so far.
Good.
So
well, we're looking forward to getting Gail with the council at a workshop as early as possible in January, and then we'll go from there.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Oh, that's right. We're out of order. That's right. Oh, yeah. We are. Oh, fine. Are there any other reports and correspondence?
I would just like to say, Madam Chairman, that I served on the first town council in 1967 to 71, and now I'm on the council that's going to say goodbye to the 1900s and into the 2000s, and I'm very grateful to the citizens of the town for having allowed me to serve in that position, and I enjoy my colleagues on the council. I think we have a wonderful council as far as working together. I'd like to echo your sentiments. And we don't have some of the squabbles that we read about in the paper where other communities are all up in arms about various things and recalls and whatnot. I think that we have differences and that we work them out in the democratic process. And I'm very grateful to be here, and I'd like to say Merry Christmas and Happy New Year to everybody.
Thank you, Henry. Councilor Fritz.
I just wanted to commend the people who have sent us correspondence on the dogs on the beach issue. I think there's have been some very, very thoughtful comments that I think we can try and work with, whether we have a public forum to try and get everybody on the beach in a congenial kind of way. I hope that comes to pass. And the other thing that I just wanted to mention was that I was very privileged to attend a concert in Portland Saturday that was with the Portland String Quartet that had a competition and for students in high school music programs around the greater Portland area. And it was very pleasing to have two of the four winners of that competition being from Cape Elizabeth. And those two winners were Kelly Reed and Elizabeth Geyer playing the flute, both of them with, they did a Mozart flute quintet with the Portland String Quartet. It was very encouraging to see. Yeah.
Any other reports and correspondence? Yes.
I wanted to mention that on December 3rd, the town had an employee recognition luncheon that I was lucky to attend, being a town employee now. It was a great afternoon. I had a lot of fun, and I wanted to express thanks to everybody who's a town employee, because I think they do a great job of making Cape a wonderful place to live, and I enjoyed meeting some people I had never met before that afternoon, so I just wanted to thank them for all their efforts.
I hope they protect your mailbox when the snow flies, too. All right, is there any more correspondence? Reports? Thank you. Town manager's report.
Because of the lateness of the hour and a lot of people here on other items, I'll defer giving a report.
Fine, thank you. Any citizens' items, citizens' discussion of items not on the agenda? Hearing none, we will move on to the minutes of the November 8th, you have to be very fast, of the November 8th, 1999 meeting.
Madam Chairman, I've moved that the minutes of the November 8th meeting be approved as read.
Second.
It's been moved and seconded. Any discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? Thank you. Now, first item on the agenda, we'll open the public hearing. It's a public hearing in consideration of public comments on a proposed revision to the sewer rate schedule. I'll ask the manager to make a comment before about what this is.
Yeah, thank you, Madam Chairman. For many years, the town council and town staff have heard complaints regarding the way that Cape Elizabeth bills its sewer bills to multi-unit dwellings. Specifically, every other community bills sewer on a per meter basis. Cape Elizabeth, amongst the Portland Water District communities, bills it on a per unit basis. That therefore results in apartment houses, multi-unit dwellings, paying a lot more in Cape Elizabeth because they have to pay a minimum times the number of units. The town council during the budget process last year began to approach this issue and indicated they'd like to review it at a more opportune moment. In order to give the folks who were concerned about this issue an opportunity to present their views, the town council did schedule a public hearing on it. The proposal that's before the council this evening is revenue neutral as far as the amount of money that the town gets from sewer fees. But in order to reduce by reducing the total number of minimum charges, you do need to increase the rates otherwise in order to gain back that revenue, assuming we'd want a revenue neutral. The effect of that is to change the minimum charge that's currently $26.50 per month to $27.80, and to change the $3.82 per 100 cubic foot charge up to $4. The actual effect is 4.01, but to revenue neutrality, but rounding it back down to $4. If the council was inclined to do this after the public hearing, there is a draft proposed rate schedule for you to consider. Also, a on pages 4 and 3 of your package, is the, what the current rate is with the underlines and the crossouts. But what you'd actually be adopting is the new, if you chose to do this, would be on the one-headed draft proposed sewage rates, rate sheet as proposed if enacted. Again, increasing the minimum from 2650 to 2780, increasing the consumption from 382 per 100 to $4, and going to have this based on per meter instead of per unit.
Thank you. Now the public hearing is open on this issue. Is there anyone who wishes to speak to that issue?
Ireland.
Yes.
I am Marlon Davis. I'm here for Woodland South. And I guess I'd like to say that it's an awkward moment for me in front of the Millennium Council, the state golf and soccer champs, report from the Historic Committee, the police department, and apparently the entire fire department, to have the opportunity to talk to you about sewer minimums in the last meeting of the century. But this is an issue that has been around since 1977. When the town established the sewers, when they looked for revenue, they looked for particular units, since the town is basically made up of residences. It did leave a number of properties that were multifamily properties that were looked at as being individual homes. The result was that a multifamily property that uses the same amount of water as a neighbor in a house next door pays approximately 60% more for the exact same service and the exact same sewer. And it's just a system that we don't feel should continue. There's a couple of other wrinkles, as Mike says in some of his correspondence, in that the school is charged for so many students. I know over a period of years that's been an issue with them. And also nursing homes for so many beds. And what it amounts to is, instead of all of us paying just for what we use, and all of us are paying exactly the same, and it's the exact same playing field, some people in the town are paying much less, some people are paying in the middle, and some people, namely people that have multifamily apartment buildings, are paying at the very top of the scale. And in fact, for probably 15 years of the 20 years that this has been in effect, the property that I represent, we were using approximately 125 to 150 CHCFs per unit, where if it was a house, it would be used, it's almost 10 times as much. It would take us 10 units to come up with a house for an average flow. And we were paying for 10 homes. And where a house would be using 1.5, where an apartment would be using 1.5, we were being billed 3. So it actually resulted in us paying approximately twice as much for almost 15 years, which, you know, isn't an issue now, but you know, we've paid for many, many years, and we've put a lot into the system. The whole thing to change, I think, is $92,000. $45,000 or so is the school. If that was taken out of the general fund instead of the sewer fund, that's a wash. You're down to about $45,000. And there was at one time $60,000 that was contributed from the town for streets and catch basins and things of that nature. And if that was still in there, this wouldn't even be an issue to even raise rates. But it's just something that in area towns, I took a sampling in Scarborough, South Portland, Portland. I spoke with all of the directors of their pollution control systems there. And actually, they couldn't even figure out what I was talking about, because all of their systems are done on flow. Because when I was speaking with one of them, they said, how would we know how many units someone had in a building? Or if they got a permit and put in another unit, we're supposed to charge another minimum, we wouldn't even know. So they want to run it all off a meter, and you have so much flow, you have so much cost, and you pay exactly the same as everyone else. So it's important not to look at it as a break for people and someone else's fees go up. It isn't really a break, it's just bringing us down that we're paying exactly the same as everyone else, and that's all we want, is just an equality in the system.
Thank you.
That's all I have to say this evening.
Are you the son?
Yes.
When I was on the council before, your father was here to say that so much time has passed.
The file's about this thing.
I'm sure.
It goes way back that, you know, we've tried to, you know, and I mean, we want it to be painless. I mean, we're part of the, I represent 54 Cape Elizabeth families, the Cape Elizabeth residents. And, you know, I don't want anyone else's bill to go up or have it reflected that we're trying to increase somebody's bill. We just want to have it so that we pay exactly the same as everyone else would.
Thank you. Thank you very much. Are there any other comments from the public on this issue? Yes.
Hello, my name is Max Sexton, and I live in South Portland. Actually, my backyard at my home is in Cape Elizabeth, so I'm one of the lucky people who gets to pay property taxes on my house to both jurisdictions. But my wife and I also own a two-family in Cape Elizabeth on Clinton Road, and we own an eight-unit on the side of the old cottage farm school on Woodland Road. And I've thought all along, since we have owned these properties, that we were paying our sewer charges on the basis of usage. And silly me, I found out about 2 weeks ago that it hasn't been the case. And when I became educated on this, I decided I really, in the interest of equity, I should come to support Mr. McGovern's proposal to you, which I think corrects an inequity in the current billing system. And I just did an example from my own situation. If you consider that a bedroom might have, one bedroom in the community might have the same usage as another bedroom, and you just take some hypothetical examples. If you take my example, I have an eight unit, each with two bedrooms, so there's 16 bedrooms. It so happens that there is one person in each of those units. So there are only eight people in my building, but there are 16 bedrooms. For those 16 bedrooms, I pay eight minimum charges. And then I pay, in addition to that, for the usage. A 16-bedroom home, I don't know whether there are any in Cape Elizabeth, but if there are,
soon, maybe.
Maybe a couple. A 16-bedroom home would pay one minimum and not eight. And a 16-bedroom nursing home or assisted living facility would pay five minimum charges. So it seems to me that there is an inequity there. And for the same number of bedrooms in different facilities and in terms of minimum charges. And frankly, I don't see why you just don't charge for usage straight across the board for everybody. That'd be fine. But if you have to have a minimum charge, it seems to me the most equitable way to do that is by meter. So if you got a meter, you pay a minimum charge. And then in addition to that, you pay for your usage. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Are there any other comments from the public on this issue? Hearing none, I declare the public hearing closed. I'm now ready for discussion from councilors on this item. Councilor Barrett.
I think the proposal seems fair, and for the explanation that's given, it seems equitable to everybody. And I don't think people having apartments should be paying 60% more. On behalf of the Effluent Society, I would like to make a motion that the rate sheet as proposed, if enacted, be enacted. Do you want me to read the entire order? As printed here, a draft proposal is to change the rates just as said, and I would move that the rate of $27.80 up to 100 cubic feet of monthly measured water usage and $4 for each additional 100 cubic feet or fraction thereof of monthly measured usage be that's essentially the part of the ordinance that is stated here. But as read, I would move it be passed.
Is there a second?
Second.
Okay. Discussion. Councilor Fritz.
I guess I'm, at least at this point, I'm not going to support this motion and the change. It's nice to count bedrooms, but I think there are a lot of single people living in individual homes that would use the same amount of water as one person in an apartment would use. So I think the way we're doing it now is the way to balance the differences. I mean, I don't think it's fair to count one house the same as one whole building of apartments or one whole nursing home. It seems to me that what we have right now is more equitable. And I also feel that our sewer rates are, even though I'm not on a sewer, are extremely high. And I don't think that the rates should be shoved any higher than they are now.
Okay. Madam Chair, I agree with part of what Councilor Fritz says. I too think our sewer rates are very high. I know a few years ago we did our best to restructure it and to lower the rates a little bit. But I think we need to come up with equity, but I hate to do that at the price of everyone else paying more. And that's a dilemma that I'm facing with this motion right now that's on the floor. I think that we need to, you know, the apartment buildings, if I hear them correctly, we're charging a minimum fee and usage as well. Is that correct? Yes. And in a home, we're only charging usage. Is that correct? My understanding. All right. So there's a discrepancy there. Is that right?
Yeah,
there's a minimum, too.
You do a minimum as well.
There's a minimum. Okay. So if we then realign it to be more like the apartments to be more like a single family residence, what we're taking away is, what are we taking away?
For example, if you have a single-family home, the single-family home pays one minimum of the current $2,650,
right,
and then they pay for each additional 100 cubic feet of water above the initial 100 allowance,
right, okay,
the $3.86, I believe it is, 82 okay. cents. Thank you.
Okay.
If you have a 10-unit apartment, you pay 10 minimums, or 10 times the $2,650, $265 per month.
Mm-hmm.
Plus, you also pay for water usage at the rate of $3.82 per 100 cubic feet after your initial allowance of 10 100 cubic feet or 1,000 cubic feet, because you get an allowance under this current system of 100 cubic feet for each minimum. Under the new proposed system, every meter, you know, an apartment house could still have 4 meters. We don't know that. Every meter would still pay the new minimum of $27.80, and they would get for each meter the 100 cubic foot allowance, and they'd pay $4 for each additional 100 cubic feet. And the single would be the same, the single family home, the $27.80 per month plus the first 100 cubic feet plus an additional 400.
What would we have to do to keep the rates the way they are but allow equity to the apartment houses? I mean, is that's not possible?
Yes, it is. The council had a discussion on that during the budget session, and my initial proposal was to take it out of the general fund, and the town council didn't feel that the regular taxpayers, particularly those on sewer, should not pay for lowering the sewer rates or making the equity within the system for the apartments, nor for the school department. This would, you know, we haven't really talked about it too much. Mr. Davis alluded to it. This would also reduce the school sewer bill by about $25,000 to $30,000from what it is now.
$25,000 to $30,000 a year
reduction in the school sewer bill as well, because they would also be on a per meter system instead of on the one user unit or one minimum for every 10 students, faculty, and staff, which is the current system.
So am I correct in understanding that currently apartment owners, and one would assume since things get passed along through rent, people who live in apartments are paying higher rates? They're sort of subsidizing the rest of the people in town who live in single-family homes.
You know, it's just a matter
depends,
of interpretation.
It depends which way you're looking at it. One group is subsidizing the other, or the people who would be against the change now would be saying the same thing, only in reverse. Is that...
But if you have one person in an apartment, shouldn't that be equal to one person in a house? They're using about the same amount of water. Isn't that an equivalent way...
But we have no control over how many people live in a single-family home or how many people live in an apartment, and unless we're going to...
But they're still using the same amount of water.
And I think if they're using the same amount of water...
Amount of usage.
It should be... I'm saying that I think it should be more equitable, and I think right now what has been happening over the past 15 years is that the people who own and then the people who live in multi-unit homes have been paying more than their share. They've been subsidizing, in effect, the people who live in single-family homes.
I think I'm going to have Michael address something that you've said.
The cost of the sewer, the construction of it, the debt, the amounts we pay to South Portland, where most of the apartments are, that's totally based on flow going through the system. It's not based on units. So if you try to attach cost to it, or you look at sewer capacities, I know as you often do, Councilor Fritz, it has nothing at all to do with the number of user units. It has everything to do with the volume of water going through the system. That's why it's crucially important that we reduce infiltration in the system, because that long-term does reduce our costs. But all of our costs are driven by flow, and the need for sewers are determined by flow and not by the number of units.
Should I ask Mr. Manager, do other schools in other towns, schools and towns pay on the same basis per staff, per student, per number of human beings in the building?
No. I had a meeting late this afternoon with the Director of Administration for the Portland Water District. We had a long discussion about this. Actually, we were selling Christmas trees together for the Rotary Club. And we are the only community that has the rate structure of the type that we do. Everyone else is based on, you got a meter, you get a bill.
Yeah.
Based on the flow. We're an exception.
Yes.
Madam Chair, if it's based on flow, and if we have meters, then if we just switch it to flow, why do we have to adjust our rates? Why do our rates have to go up if it's based on flow?
If you go back to my 10 user unit example, right now they're paying a minimum of $265 a month. Under this new system, they'd be paying a minimum, if there was just one meter, of $27.80 a month. Even with the flow allowances, you know, because they're still going to be billed on consumption, their bill would probably be maybe $100 per month rather than $265. That $165 savings that they get is then distributed over the whole pool, including those units themselves. Even the multi-units are still going to have their minimum go up just like everyone else, except they'd be paying one minimum per meter instead of one minimum per unit. So it's as a result of the revenue will be going down, because instead of paying 60% more, as Mr. Davis has indicated, they would be paying on a consumption basis the same as everyone else.
Yes, Councilor Roberts.
Several of my questions have been answered already, but getting back to the school, how is the school sewer bill currently being paid?
They're not. Everyone else is billed through the Portland Water District. With the school department, we simply do a direct entry in our accounting system, and they get an invoice for their the full amount of their bill once a year, and they just credit it to the sewer account. It's all internally. Under this new system, it would be included as part of their water bill like every other sewer user in town.
So currently, everyone is paying through the general taxes to pay for the water and sewer that goes to the school department. And under this proposal, only people who have sewers will be picking up that additional list now on the general?
No. The Cape Elizabeth School Department, currently, you know, you've done some adjustments over the years, and I think the bill is around $54,000. They did an analysis because they were very upset at this, of what their bill would be if they were on meter. And it came up to, it was between $21,000 and $24,000. I don't remember the exact. They will still be paying $21,000. They'll be paying an equitable bill, just like any other sewer user, based on their flow going into the sewer. They may want to get sub-meters for their outside watering, that type of thing. But they will be just like anyone else. But their bill going down by approximately $20,000 to $30,000, that is distributed all amongst the other sewer users. Because the initial proposal that Mr. Davis was quoting from back last May provided that some of that would be transferred to the general fund, and the town council said, no, that's a sewer expense. It ought to be borne by sewer users, and the council did not want the general fund at that time subsidizing the sewer fund.
So the school cost is going down, and it's being spread amongst all the other sewer users, and those of us that don't have sewers are going to be cut a break on it. How many households are not sewered, what percentage, in the community? It needs to be fair and equitable, and I'm not on a sewer either. I stand to gain, but that doesn't sound fair to me.
Well, it's roughly a third have been not on sewer.
That needs to be changed on the funding somehow or other.
So then...
Wait, Councilor McGinty, please.
How many apartment units are there that are on sewer? There's approximately 150 units. I don't remember the exact amount. I don't know if it's in here. I think it is in here. This is fine print, excuse me.
It is tiny. For us older folk.
It's my recollection is it's about 150.
Councilor Fritz.
Excluding the school department issue.
So then how would, if we made this change, how would that affect the nursing home?
They would be like anyone else. They'd be based on a meter. The proposal here is to move everyone to paying for their flows based on a minimum for each meter that they may have. And I can't say that Mr. Davis would go down to one minimum because he may have four meters. The Viking may have more than one meter. They'll be paying per meter.
May I? How many of the rents would go down when the sewer fees go down to the units?
It's true. But we can't. We're not in charge of that. I thought about it. Councilor McGinty.
Well, that is another issue, Jack. And I was just mulling it over my head. You know, I used to own rental property, and it's a business. Now, these are business properties, and certainly the people who live there don't look at it that way. But it's a business for the people who own the properties, and that's a little bit different than a single-family home. That I mean, it's your residence. I mean, it's not a business. It's your personal property. And so maybe there is a reason to think of it a little differently than just the people living there, that it is, in fact, a business we're talking about.
Is there any more discussion? We haven't seemed to come to any real compromise here. There is a motion on the floor. Are you ready, John?
No, I'm all for equity. I think the same thing. I mean, it seems to be out of balance, but I'm not in favor of raising everybody else's sewer fees, taxes, and to solve this problem. I don't know what the solution is, but I don't think it's raising everybody's rates. And at this point, unless somebody says something to change my mind, I can't support the motion.
Madam Chair, yes. I would just like to pick up on something that Jack mentioned. And if we're changing these sewer rates, and if the school system is going to be saving $25,000 to $30,000, and only the sewer users are picking up that savings, I think he has a point about spreading that out among all people, you know, all residents, not just sewer. How you address that, I have no idea. But I'm of the same opinion now of Carol and of John. As it stands right now, I can't support this either.
I just want to correct a misunderstanding. If the school department's sewer bill is cut $20,000 to $30,000, that isn't a savings by the sewer. You said only the people in sewer are going to save that. That's a savings for all of the taxpayers across the entire community. It's not a savings to the sewer users. It's for all of the taxpayers.
Well, I know, but what we're doing is we are increasing the rates of the people on sewer to reduce what the school system's paying, and everybody in the whole town of Cape Elizabeth attends the schools, not just people whose kids are on sewer. So, you know, I think we need to look at this again.
Well, if I could just add, however, not everybody in town, I think we're getting sort of nitpicky here, but only 20% of the families in Cape Elizabeth have kids in the school system. Mm-hmm. So really only 20%. I don't know how you figure all these percentages and averages, but I don't think it's correct to say that everybody has kids in the school system, because that's
but every taxpayer is burdened by that additional $25,000 or $30,000, whether your child is in the school system or not.
And now the people who happen to live in apartments are sort of subsidizing everybody else, presuming that the costs of the owner, as John says, are being passed through. And I just don't think it's right that people who happen to live in multi-unit homes should be subsidizing everybody else. And I understand that most people in town don't live in apartments, so it's a lot easier for us to say, let's put it on the people who live in apartments, because there's not too many of them, and we'll just keep everybody else happy by not raising their rates, the people who live in single-family homes. And I just think we're unfairly penalizing the people who live in apartments. So I don't see the system as equitable now. I know it's been going on for 15 or however many years, but just because it's been going on doesn't mean it was right, and it doesn't mean it's right to continue it. I'd like to see a more equitable system. And I think this proposal is a revenue-neutral proposal for the whole town, and that's why we're trying to spread the dollars around from one group to another. So if we lower it for one group, we're going to raise it a little bit for the other group. But right now, we've got it raised artificially high for the people who live in apartment buildings to keep everybody else's artificially low. So, and that's why I'm supporting it.
Excuse me, this is Councilor Watson. I can't remember. I was listening, and now I can't remember exactly what you said. But you said something about the $30,000 that's less in the school is going to be picked up by somebody else, you said, by the rest of the public? How is it that, anyway, I don't think...
Well, we have to raise the rate from $26 per whatever to $27 to compensate for this adjustment.
Mm-hmm.
So, and that's going to benefit the apartment buildings and make it more equitable, and it's also going to benefit the schools. But at the same time, all the other sewer users are paying an additional, $1.30 of a minimum charge, an additional 18, 19 cents per cubic feet. So in order to allow that to happen, the rates of sewer users have to go up to compensate to make equity.
Mm-hmm.
And that was my point.
Okay, I understand that. I get what you're saying. Well, my position is that I was here from day one on the sewers for 10 years in the council. That's all we talked about. That was the number one issue, I think, at every single meeting was sewers. And I always thought that it was that the method that we used for multi-units was not correct, and that we probably should not have done it then. So I will support this as presented forward. This has been 15 years, long years. And I'd like to think that the rates in the apartments would go down, but that's a business issue. I think that this is only the fair thing to do, and I think it's fair to everybody. And I am on the sewer, and I will bear the brunt of that. But I don't want to pay any higher fees, and most everybody doesn't. It's a very small amount, but I think it's not fair to be subsidized by those individual businesses in town. So that's what my position is. Is there any more discussion? Are we ready to call a question? And there's a motion on the table to
adopt.
That you did this and it was seconded. All right. All those in favor? Okay. Three. All those opposed? Three?
I'm going to abstain.
How can you?
Can I do that? Can I abstain?
No.
No, okay. Then
do you have conflict or something?
Well, no, just because I'm really unclear as to which way to vote on this. I mean, this doesn't happen very often for me, that I don't have a clear view of which way to go. My inclination is to vote against this, but at the same time, I think we need to have some parity. I'd really like to have us revisit this. Mm-hmm.
So, okay.
So, if you need me to vote...
Well, I think it's... I think you have
no.
to vote.
No, I vote no.
I mean, I wish you didn't, because it is not my position. But.
I know.
Madam Chair, I mean, I have the same concern she does. I mean, I think we can revisit this. I think it's not fair either, but I just don't think this, well, there's got to be a better way, is what I'm saying.
Yeah.
And, I mean, let's work on this and try to find a better way to resolve it. That's where I stand on it.
The motion has gone forward, fails by a majority, simple majority, and so I think probably if it is the sense of the council that you'd like to revisit this issue, that can be done, and that we'll have it. Maybe we'll have to do this more serious, in-depth conversation with the manager to understand these sewer rates and understand how the impact is, to see if we can make this equitable to somebody. All right. Item number 61, public hearing and consideration of approval of in-by-the-sea liquor licenses and special amusement permits. This town clerk, please.
Thank you. In your packets, you do have a renewal application from the Inn by the Sea for the liquor license. The special amusement permit is a new application. There is nothing changed at the Inn by the Sea. They had marked off that they do allow dancing and entertainment on the premises, so it does require a special amusement permit. Again, this would be maybe music accompanying a wedding ceremony or something, but there is nothing changing at the Inn in that regard. So the application is in order for you to act upon it this evening.
Fine.
Is there
Public hearing is now open on this issue. We have comments, please, from the public. Are there any comments from the public? Hearing none, I declare the public hearing closed. Council, we have a motion and then some discussion. Councilor Fritz.
I'm just wondering, is someone here representing the Inn by the Sea?
Is there somebody?
Sir Legg is here.
Oh, Sir Legg is here. You have some questions?
Yeah, I just had a question about the type of special events that you were expecting to hold.
This is the same.
I mean, there was...
No difference here.
There seemed to be an indication of just small musical ensembles, very small jazz or classical or something like that, outside. Is that the limit of what you would have
yes.
outdoors?
Yeah.
So that it would be, I guess there had been some complaints about
yeah.
some music, which I guess you responded to well when you were notified of it.
Yeah.
Chairman, perhaps
yes.
I should abstain from voting on this because I have provided, I hope, some entertainment for weddings, played piano at the place. If you consider that a conflict of interest, then I should abstain. I'll leave it to you.
I don't personally consider that a conflict of interest, and I don't know how the rest of the council feels, Henry.
You can't get out of it that easy.
You can't get out of it that easy. We like hearing you play the piano, so.
Thank you very much. I'll vote for it.
Okay.
You're not
need
generally.
A motion first. Councilor Roberts.
Madam Chairwoman, does anybody have any idea how many households are within, say, 1,000 feet of that? I know in the summertime, I have a very good concert quite often on Saturday at my house, and I'm way across the pond, so I can't imagine the neighbors being in close proximity to it, why they're not complaining more. Is there?
I think we don't have very many. It's probably one or two every Saturday, it's a Saturday event, and it's one every 7 days, so really I don't think becomes an issue.
Right. Councilor McGinty.
I have a question regarding the chief's memo. It says that there are occasionally complaints, but he doesn't either endorse or not endorse the application. It's rather neutral. He just says that these occasionally have problems. Does he support, or I mean, whatever the word is?
I don't, yes, the clerk,
sorry.
Please.
What we do for liquor applications, as you know, has been requested by the council. We run it by our two public safety chiefs and the code enforcement officer. And simply what they do is give us information, facts, and that's all that the chief did. He doesn't endorse it one way or the other. He has never been asked to do that, nor is it his role to do that, nor mine. We're just saying that the application is complete. Do we see any reason to deny it? Probably not.
Well, that's my question. There's no reason that he sees to deny it. I mean, if we're having a bunch of Donnybrooks there, brawls and shootings and stuff, I think
you'd have heard about it by now.
Yeah.
That would have been in the report.
Been in the courier.
The piano's very quiet.
It's emotional. All right, I'll entertain a motion for this item.
I'll move approval of the application.
Second.
Okay, it's been moved and seconded. Any further discussion? All those in favor? Opposed? Motion carries. Thank you. Item number 62, consideration and action on request to approve the concept plan for improvements to the public safety facilities, to authorize funds for design and permitting, and to consider a request to fund transition costs. I'll let the manager make this presentation.
Yes, but before I do that, Madam Chairman, I'm going to refer to an awful lot of numbers. And what I've done is taken the two major memos that I've given to the council on this issue, and I've made photocopies this evening, and I've put numbers on all the pages. This is no new information to the town council that you're receiving this evening. It's the same information, only it has numbers on the pages. So, you know, I know sometimes you accuse me of giving you information at the last minute. There is nothing here that's new. It's only page numbers. So.
Thank you, John.
I also have some members for the public. I made about 20 copies, so if someone wants to grab these and distribute them. Thanks, Carl. I'm going to do a little introduction, and then I'm going to be starting on when we get on the numbers on page 11. I'm very pleased to see such a good turnout here on this issue, and frankly quite surprised to see a good turnout on this issue. I didn't expect to see this sizable group here this evening. What you have before you this evening is a unanimous recommendation from the Facilities 2000 Committee. The Facilities 2000 Committee was made up of a number of Cape Elizabeth residents from various talents and expertise in the community. They've been studying this issue for a little over a year, this particular committee. There were also at least two or three predecessor committees, maybe even four predecessor committees, that have been looking at the issues of public safety facilities as well as municipal, general municipal facilities since sometime in the early 1980s. The need to address public safety facilities within the community, and particularly the police department facility, was first identified, I think, as early as 1983, when it was noted the cramped storage space they had. And then over the number of years, the various committees have looked at that, and they've eventually, I think, looked at probably close to 50 alternatives for solving the space needs of the police department, as well as looking at fire department space needs. The town council embarked upon a plan, has goals in which that it addressed that it wished to look at the public safety space needs, and it actually wished to address them this year by moving ahead, by first, and you've done an awful lot of work on that this year. The swimming pool is due to be completed December 22nd. With an opening early in January. The public works garage is now under construction. And you also have this concept plan that was prepared by the Facilities 2000 Committee. The overall cost at this point, from this point on, for the public safety facilities, as proposed by the Citizen Committee, is $2.9 million. $1.1 million of that is for renovating the current public works garage and adding an addition onto it. And the balance is for building a totally new police station at the site of the current public safety building. As the council is aware from a workshop you had with the Facilities 2000 Committee, much study was done of whether or not to try to renovate the existing building or to build a new building. And it was believed in looking at all the numbers and reports as early in 1999 that the committee reviewed that it is less expensive to build a new building than it is to try to renovate that building in meeting the concept plan that was developed. There's also been some discussion at looking at other sites, maybe looking at the service station lot in back of us, and unfortunately for the police station portion. And when we look at that, we find that lot simply doesn't have anywhere near the depth that the lot over where the public safety building has. It would accommodate it very closely for the width, but it would not accommodate it for the depth. there's an awful lot of concern, rightfully so, as to how this $2.9 million translates into impact on the tax rate. And that's what I'd like to spend a little bit of time going over this evening, beginning on page 11. And I want to run through these numbers. I particularly want to do it because the numbers are presented in two different ways. And I want to be absolutely clear that everyone understands the differences in the two ways the numbers are presented and how, in the end, all of the numbers are, in fact, the same. The only difference is if you look at it in the concept of the entire budget or you look at it solely to do with these public safety facilities. So beginning on page 11, if you look at the fiscal year 2000 budget, $6.5 million roughly, and I'll be rounding some of these numbers, that is the current adopted municipal and county budget, which is from, which you can also see the proof to that is on page 13, line 1. During this next year, we're estimating, this whole sheet is looking at the impact of this when you also look at the rest of the municipal county budget. You know, what are we truly going to be talking for tax dollars so that we don't look at this as one thing alone, because there's always a question, what else is coming up, what else is there to deal with? This looks at everything else. We're projecting that the county tax will go up approximately $25,000. We don't know the amount yet. The last I heard, the county had not finished its review. If you look at additional debt service, in next year's budget, and on page 9 of the report, it proofs to that, it's $230,000 in additional debt service costs. And that is, only about $125,000 of that is for the public safety buildings. The rest is additional debt service costs that is not yet budgeted for the public works barrage portion and for the swimming pool. Additional other $175,000, that's looking at the balance of the entire municipal budget and estimating, we don't know if this will be the amount, but giving an allowance of 3% to the rest of that budget. That's everything from utilities to heating oil costs, which will go up, payroll, all those things. We're also looking at additional pool operating costs, since the pool is going to be open for the full year, of $90,000. That adds up all of those numbers to a projected municipal county budget next year of $7,059,000. Looking back at this year's budget, again on page 13, the total amount of revenues for the town budget is about $2.9 million. We have projected next year, solid projections, very solid, at least $305,000 in additional revenues above the point we are now. That's on page 10 of the report, if you want to show that. And I am estimating excise taxes, more realistic, we're taking a little bit more out of surplus. We've really looked at all the revenues, where they're coming from, and feel very comfortable projecting an additional $305,000. That adds up to revenues of $3.2 million. You look at last year's net to property taxes, the adopted budget, we're at, on page 13, we're at $3,644,000. The projection for next fiscal year, which is 2001, if you take that $7,059,000 expenditures, subtract from it $3.2 million, the balance that would need to be left is $3,859,138. The valuation that this year's tax rate is based on is $697 million. The current tax rate for municipal and county services is $5.25. Next year, the valuation is projected to be $710 million, has increased about $13 million. If you look at that projected net to taxes of next year, $3,859,000, you divide that by the valuation, you come up with a projected tax rate for next year, including the first impact of this project, the $125,000, plus, because it's looked to be brought in over 2 years, plus fully incurring the debt for the pool, for the public works garage, and for the pool operating and everything else in the budget, the county, comes up to $545,000. That's a 20-cent difference. The current tax rate is $19.86 in total, $19.86. So roughly $20, yes, 14 cents left, but for estimating purposes, $20. If you look at 20 cents of $20, which is the increase from 525 to 545, that's an increase of 1%. Also, on the next page, page 12, projected, well, you haven't got it all there yet, what happens in fiscal year 2002. And again, we start at the top line with what I indicate the estimated budget is for 2001. We assume the county will go up again. We look at the balance of debt service needed, about $140,000. We look at additional other, again, that for the rest of the budget, another $175,000. That adds up to 7.4. This year's revenues we're projecting up over $300,000. Next year, a little more conservative, at this point only estimating $150,000, or half the increase that we had this year. That adds up to a projected net to taxes for 2001 of 3859. The following year would be a little over $4 million. That brings it up with more valuation at the bottom line there to 562. That's an increase of 17 cents. So when we look at the entire municipal county budget, including all the other factors not related to these projects at all, the projection is that we're looking at an increase of 20 cents in year one coming up and 17 cents in year two. I then look at, because I think the question ought to come up, well, we bought the Levitt property, we bought this, we did that, we did everything. Since 1996, the fiscal year 96, through the end of fiscal year 2002, it's a total increase of 78 cents for all of those years. And I think, you know, if anyone, I know everyone always looks back at numbers, but if we added up all of these projects and what we projected for tax increases, I think in every instance it's come out less because we've had other revenues to apply to it. That's why it's important. I think you look at it this way and you see that the real impact, once you take everything else into consideration, is 1% this year, 1% next year. What we don't know is the school department. And you never know the school department until the state legislature adopts the budget every year. But, you know, I think, you know, my sense is that, you know, this is a manageable debt limit. I think particularly when you begin to look at other sheets that Councillor McGinty had asked me for. And if you look at page 5, I think where the follow-through is, and these numbers are looking at tax rate impact of simply the debt service alone without considering the fact that there may be other revenues, there may be other expenditures that the town's looking at. Everyone understand the distinction?
Mm-hmm.
One is you're looking at the entire budget. This you're solely looking at debt service. In fiscal year 2000, we only have an interest payment for Gulfcrest and the pool project, so it's only 18 cents. In reality, why it's tough to go through some of these numbers is we had $451,000 in the budget, but some of that was for other purposes, but it was for implementing this whole initiative. So while it shows it going from 18 cents to 79 cents next year, the reality is when you put everything else in, it is only that 20 cents. Because even though it isn't in that debt service line per se, because the debt service for this year ended up being much less than anticipated, because we borrowed it much later than we anticipated. We borrowed the money later, and we went on our cash flow, which really saved the budget a lot of money this year. We only used, for an interest payment, $129,000. The projection is that next year we'll have $125,000, which again, if you remember, that was the amount of additional debt put in the budget, so we're right on target next year. That's in 2002. So when we get to that point, we go to 90, eventually, with the public safety debt, it eventually goes, including public safety, Gulfcrest, if you look at the right column, we're up to a high year that all of these projects add up to $1.15, taken alone without allocating any other revenues to it. You know, if we weren't in, you know, looking, that was the one thing we had to look at, that is in fact the impact. You then look at the balance of these numbers, and because we borrow level principal payments, and the cost actually goes down because the interest cost goes down, the actual impact on the tax rate goes down. So when you look at this far right column, this isn't additional budget increases every year. this is actually decreases of 4 cents, 2 cents, 5 cents each year. So the worst impact of all of this is in fiscal year 2003, where it's $1.15. You then move on to the next sheet, page 6. And again, I've repeated the first column from the previous page. You can follow it along. I then looked at, well, what about the rest of the debt that the town has, so we know the full picture. If you look at all of that, the peak is $1.50 in 2003. And then it drops by 11 cents, by 7 cents, by 14 cents, by 8 cents. You wonder, you know, where, Mike, did you get these projections? Are they worth anything? Well, if you look at the December 1 memo, I had projected that the interest principal payment for the first full year of public safety would be $300,000. Between then and December 8th, I asked Joe Pitaro, our professional financial advisor, to do the rate schedules that the council received that you see on page 7. His number came out $300,512. So my projection was 0.2% off, which, you know, is pretty good. We still don't know where the interest rates are, but that's the difference, if there's any question at all, between the two sets of numbers. One is simply this project alone, and one is when you look at it in the terms of the rest of the budget. So it comes out to 1% impact on the tax rate this year and next year, when all is said and done, when you look at the entire budgets. And I think, you know, and the really good news is that once you've done that, the impact is actually less each year by 11 cents, by 14 cents, by 12 cents. So I think the real issue is, you know, can we afford to do all this? Is can we afford a 1% increase each of the next 2 years for this when we're also doing all these other things in the municipal and school side, including paying for the pool, paying for public works? And I think, you know, that's a judgment, you know, ultimately the town council needs to make. You know, in closing, you know, I'd like to say, you know, I'd like to go into a few, one other piece. Part of the proposal, and I might as well talk about it now, is that in addition to authorizing the monies for the design, you're also being asked for $150,000 to begin the process right away of putting an addition on to the front of the current public works garage. And that is new in this agenda. You know, it was in your packet, but it was not discussed at your workshop. The reason for that is that when we really began to look at implementation, when we were listening to councilors, I remember Councillor Watson in particular, said you were really concerned about trying to do it as one major project in order to get it done quicker, and in, that there might be some bid savings by doing it all together. We took that to heart and really looked at it, and particularly when we found shuffling communications equipment around or whatever, that there really is some savings at doing it, but we really can't move everything to the current public works garage until we first put that building on. And we have, for example, the dispatch, 911 is due to go in July. We'd be having that put in July. All of that additional equipment would then need to be moved to the public works garage in November, December. We would then need to move it back to the new building. So we're looking at reducing 3 moves down to 2 moves. Obviously, there's a savings in that. Then you ask, you know, why don't we just wait for 911? Our real fear is that enhanced 911, all of the publicity will go out. It's fully in place in Greater Portland, except in Cape Elizabeth. Mm-hmm. Cape Elizabeth's not ready. I don't think that's anything that, you know, we want to have the citizens, is that we're not in the general frame of things in the Greater Portland area in terms of looking at 911 and not having it go into place when the other communities do. I don't know. As we look at all of these costs, I don't think they're going to be anywhere near the $150,000, I'll be honest. However, what I don't know, because we haven't done design yet, is if when we do that, that's also going to be the time to upgrade utilities underground before you build that addition in, because it's not designed yet, I don't know that. It might be the time that you need to upgrade the whole electrical system in the public works garage, generators, all that type of thing. And I just want to be sure that once this thing gets moving, that I'm not coming back to the council all the time for more money. I understand, and I want to reassure the council, that that $150,000 is part of the $2.9 million. That is not new money. That's part of the project. We're just doing it earlier when it makes sense to do it because of the implementation, so that we can continue to have effective public safety and have the dispatchers in a safe working environment instead of doing it later. It's, I think, you know, this has been debated now for 16, 18 years. The Facilities Committee's really done a good job coming up with a plan, and I would strongly endorse the plan of the committee and urge the council to move forward with the design and with, I think, definitely with the $150,000, because I think the dialogue, not only at the council level, but also at the staff level, has really contributed to the debate and the need that it is probably the most advantageous time to do that. Thank you. Be happy to answer any questions at whatever point you'd like.
I think there might be some questions. We're going to, yes, Councilor Barry.
Just a quick question on page four, and Mike, I don't know if it's a misprint. It says the spreadsheet show the impact is 17 cents in 2002 and 42 yes. cents in 2002. Which one, what year?
It's 17 cents additional.
In
it's what? Two yeah. 2002s there.
Yeah.
It's a 2000.
Yeah,
which is 2001?
17 is 2001, isn't it?
Yeah, the numbers are exactly the numbers on page 11.
So it's 2001 and 2002.
Yes. 2001 and 2002.
Yeah, reference. Okay. If you reference that page 11, those are the exact numbers, page 11 and 12.
Thank you.
Okay, Councilor McGinty.
I have several. I have a question and several comments.
Okay.
On page 5, Mike. You start your analysis in fiscal year 2000. If we went back one more year to 1999, the impact for the Leavitt property pool, I believe, was 38 cents. Does that have any impact on this $1.15?
No. This includes all of the. This is for the purchase of the Leavitt property?
Yes.
No, this does not include the purchase of the Leavitt property. That's why I mentioned that 78 cent amount. Because over the course from 1996 to 2002. And if you also look at the adopted budget again on page 13, which does include the Leavitt, if you go back to 99, you look at the increase, which I think is the question you're asking, Councilor. If you look at from 99 to 2000, the total tax rate increase was 0.7%. It was 14 cents. That's the year that the Leavitt property took effect. So if you're really looking at impact, we probably would have been able to avoid that 0.7%.
That's the overall budget impact, but the budget impact for the Leavitt property itself was 38 cents.
That it was, and I had indicated to the council for 3 years running that we would absorb all of the other costs in the municipal budget for all of the other increases, and any tax increases would be solely attributable to the implementation of these projects. And I think what that number shows, as you've raised it, is that we've gone beyond what I said I would do and what the council said it would do, because it wasn't a tax increase of 38 cents. It was actually a tax increase of 24 cents if you look at town and county on page 13. So we actually, we didn't do the 38 cents. We actually, in the town and county side, we did do the 38 cents, yes, but it didn't actually increase 38, it only increased 24, because 12 cents of that was taken out of savings out of the balance of municipal and county budgets.
You also mentioned that I don't particularly care to keep going through these numbers. I mean, I think that even $1.15 is a significant tax impact on this town. I mean, you keep saying 1%, but it's still a pretty big impact in my opinion. And I can't remember what I was going to make. Moving on. I had a big red flag went up when your memo came out December 1st. This was the memo that was directed towards Councilor Watson. It said, what is the cost of moving the police temporarily to the fire station? The cost estimate is $30,000. Then 2 days later, the cost estimate suddenly went to $150,000. And you've explained that somewhat. But my concern was that in a short period of 2 days, suddenly this figure, $30,000, jumped to $150,000. And it just, kind of raised a rhetorical question in my mind. Do we really have a handle on what the cost is going to be to make these projects work, build these buildings in a cost-effective manner? and you've indicated this $150,000 is already included in the budget, but I think this, you know, if we're getting memos that say one thing, and then we're getting memos that say something else, I have a concern about that, and what, you know, what's the next memo going to say, and what the impact's going to be on that, the budgetary impact's going to be on that. The second thing is, in that same memo on, well, there's no page number, but the last page, we're talking about community services, the community center, and you make a comment here, that it, and this is a quote, "It appears wiser to me to do more limited renovation of the current community center in order to get us by for a few years." Well, I have a concern about spending money to get us by for a few years, and one of my whole concerns about this whole project, or all these projects, is that we're being very, very myopic. We're looking at each building individually and saying, here's the fire building, let's look at that, what are we going to do there? Here's the police building, let's look at that, what are we going to do there? And we haven't really considered, in my opinion, what we're going to be, what are we going to be doing with community services. You say, here's a, do this renovation to get us by for a few years. Well, that's fine, but in a few years, if we start working on a community center project, a teen center project, or whatever, and we hire our consultant, and he comes back and says, geez, you know, if you'd just done something different with that police station, you know, you could have had a great master plan here for the town, but because you looked solely at the police station, that now we're stuck with what's left over for community services. And I don't even know if this committee even talked to the committee that's working community services to discuss what the impact of all this has to do with community services. Another issue, Engine 1, and I probably don't see too many people from Engine 1 here, we know that building has to have something done with it. Where does that fit into this whole project? I mean, Facilities 2000, I mean, were we going to do this, and then I know the chief's going to be knocking on our door saying, oh, by the way, now I need $1 million to renovate Engine 1. And I think we need to look at all of these issues in context and look at how they all relate to each other rather than taking each building on an, in an individual way and looking at it, as I said, very myopically in that way.
Should we prepare the answer for the first two parts, or do you want to proceed through all of the questions, which is the best?
Well, these are basically comments, and I certainly have some more, but I'd say, you know, my usual mantra is process.
Okay.
And we have the one email we have, so we have 100% correspondence that raises this issue, and it's basically, it says that, and I'll just read this part, I'm amazed the town council would spend the huge amount of money for police/fire buildings without a referendum. My comment would be, I'm surprised we're spending this money without a public forum, without a public hearing, and without any public discussion of this whatsoever, about spending virtually, it's probably going to be about $4 million. And, you know, I don't think the public really knows what's going on with this. And this individual raises an interesting question. If this was put to referendum, I wonder what the people would do, what they would say. And I'll reserve the rest of my comments.
Okay, I'm going to take that through the chair and right back to the manager.
On your first one, you appeared to be questioning my credibility in terms of the $30,000 versus the $150,000. That was my interpretation. The $30,000 was simply for the expense, John, of temporarily moving the police department to the public works garage. It had nothing to do with adding on the front of the building. It had nothing at all to do with my thought of contingencies that if you're going to add on that front part of the building, that might be the good time to do utilities and some other items. I hold 100% to the original estimate of $30,000 for the temporary transition cost of moving the police station to the public works garage. I'm not backing off at all from that. I believe that's an accurate estimate. I believe it's appropriate. I'm just looking to save the taxpayers additional money by not having to do moves two or three times when you can do it a fewer amount of times.
What was the second part?
I'm not sure.
Renovation of the community service.
Yeah,
the community service connection, I think.
Yeah.
Is it, yeah.
Yeah. Maybe I'll start writing memos. you know, where the community service office goes, you know, this project of addressing public safety needs was due to go forward before the renovation of the middle school and the elementary school. It was on track for them. What happened was, suddenly we got a new superintendent, an aggressive superintendent, who did a wonderful job of pointing out how inadequate those buildings are. And it was supported by the citizens, and even though it was only 52%, and that was a referendum that was required because it was an addition to a school building, I haven't heard too many regrets that that wasn't the right thing to do. But it was, anything we're looking at in terms of the public safety buildings has been in the context of looking at the Public Works Department. It's been in the context of looking long-term at Town Hall expansion. It's been in the context of looking at all different town properties, and it's been at police and fire. I don't know if the fire chief's going to come in to look at Engine 1 sometime, but, you know, I would trust that he would, or future chief, because that is in really poor shape. And I think, you know, that's indicative of how we've dealt with some of the other public safety facilities. Just because there's more to do at some point, you know, I'm not sure why we shouldn't need to do what clearly needs to be done now and has clearly needed to be done for a while. As for the community center and doing a Band-Aid versus long-term, you know, I understand, you know, the council has a committee looking at the community center. It has a, you know, looking at a teen center, which is fine. You know, the community center committee met last Thursday night. And that committee, I believe, unanimously said, let's see what we can do to get by for a short time. They recognize that if you do the big picture, that it might cost a couple of million dollars. However, you know, if there's a teen center aspect to this, there's a lot of issues out there, and, you know, look at process. You've got to make sure that maybe you do something a lot more inexpensive first to see the teens come to it. That's a very strong view within that committee. So, you know, it makes a lot more sense to do something short-term with the community center in terms of just seeing how the use patterns develop instead of going out and spending $2 million. And I, you know, I applaud the committee for that direction. You know, the committee that Gilly Jordan has chaired really has looked, you know, as I said, at 50, I think about 50 different alternatives, not only Gill's committee, but some of the earlier committees. No, they weren't looking at a community center. But, you know, I have looked quite a bit at a community center. And the reason it doesn't belong where the police station is because, you know, I don't hear any objection at all to putting a fire station back there. The fire department's got to stay in the middle of town because of the responses. You know, we can't have a single fire station and meet all the responses. You know, I'm not sure where else that building could go because we end up with all the footage issues. We end up with a lot more cost. If you look at that site and you look at the parking requirement for a large assembly hall, which a community center is, while there is enough parking there for a police department with offices for employees, we couldn't meet the site plan requirements of having a community center at that lot because there simply would not be the parking space. The second piece of that is the wisdom of using that lot for a community center if you have the fire department in back with all of those vehicles of the senior citizens and the youth trying to park for the community center that would be there instead of with all the fire equipment, the rescue members going back quickly. It just seems to be good planning and good process to concentrate all the public safety in that one spot, which you know, they're going elsewhere. You know, just today I heard an incident in Massachusetts. A police officer died when a state police car, he died today, a state police car hit him a few days ago when they were chasing a drug suspect. You know, that convinced me even more of the need to keep the public safety in that corridor by itself and not having a community center. So I'm going on at length, and you know how I feel on this. I think the committee has looked at a lot of these issues you're raising, and it's time to move forward.
All right. Should we move to somebody else? You have other questions, John? Any other comments on this item right now?
Madam Chair.
Yes.
Just to pick up on a little bit of what John's saying, I'm not sure that when John said community center, that's what he was referring to, and I don't want to put words in your mouth, but I think he was talking about community services, which is different. I think we understand that for safety reasons, we do not want a community center where seniors and teens are coming in out and out of, where we have a fire station with big fire engines coming and going. But I think his reference was to the back part of your memo to me that said, you know, we have an issue again. I know I'm beating a dead horse. I know I've talked about this before. But we have an issue with community services, and we have an issue with the kindergarten being in the high school. And we are going to have to step up to the plate and move the kindergarten out of the high school, put them within the school buildings. And community services, because it's not a school function, is probably going to have to leave the school buildings, and we're going to have to find another place for it. So I think that, John, I'm putting words in your mouth, were you referring to community services? So, you know, I agree with John in terms of, I think that the committee has done an outstanding job in putting this project together. But I think there's some new information here that maybe, and I don't want to put words in their mouth either, that we need to look at, and that is a little planning regarding community services in kindergarten. And I know that this project's been on hold for a long time. I think that I would feel comfortable with this project moving forward with the renovation of public works for the fire department. That step I'm pretty comfortable with. You know, if you want to put the vestibule in the front, you know, $18,000, I don't have an issue necessarily with that. But I would like to see us step back just a little bit and take a look at the police station and those renovations we're talking about there. I come back again to a report that was done in 96 by this committee that said we could put the police station on the service station lot. And again, I'm beating a dead horse. I know that's been looked at, but if I were to put a motion forward, my motion would be that we move forward with the fire department project, and that we spend 30 days looking again, stepping back and looking again at the police department's building, and if we could build it sooner, if we could somehow do the fire and police in conjunction with each other at the same time, we could save money in construction, I believe, and I think we could resolve some of our issues as it relates to communications and some of these other issues. So that would be my, where I'd like to see us go and put the police on hold for 30 days and look at it. And maybe we'll come right back and say, we're going to demolish the building, build it up from the ground, or maybe we're going to say we need to look at something else.
I just need a point of clarification. The 30 days is to not vote on this, so that we don't vote on this because...
No, to amend our motion to address the fire department's going into public works and holding to just take a look again at the police station.
No, to do what with the police station?
To decide if we want to demolish the building and renovate it and wait a year to build it, or wait a year until after public works and the fire department's built, or do we go forward and we spend $35,000 and put it on the service station lot?
It's my understanding that it couldn't fit on the service station lot anyways, and there were traffic issues, so that it's my understanding, and I've only been on the council a short time, that had been looked at several times before, and that in order to fit all the right functions in, you'd have to have a two-story building? Is that correct?
Yes. In order to do what their current design is, you would have to do a two-story building. But in the Public Safety Space Needs Review Study, final report of Cape Elizabeth 1996, conclusion, gas station lot is an appropriate size to accommodate the police department. It said it will not accommodate both fire and police departments. And in there, they even had a proposal for putting it on a Police Department Revised Scheme 18, two-story scheme, accomplishes most of the objectives for siting this facility next to Town Hall, open space amenity. The cons, possible modifications for drive alignment on north side and head-in parking next to building. So,
but has that not,
I'm sure that
has that not been superseded by the unanimous report of the building committee?
Yes, it has. It
Facilities
has been
2000 committee, and they had unanimously said that they would prefer to do the project that's before us now.
You're absolutely correct. That's right.
Okay.
You're correct in that.
But they weren't, if I may.
Yes, Jim.
Maybe this why, I guess that's why I would like to see, as Ruth said, that maybe we need to sit down and talk about this for these very issues, that we need to have a workshop to sit down and talk about, because they weren't looking at this in the context of community services either. You know, Michael has his opinion. That's fine. But again, I go back to what I said before. We're looking at each of these buildings isolated from the impact on the whole town center plan, or no plan, but the whole town center area, and that we need to hash out these things. And I would even have a concern with what Ruth said about going forward with the fire station. Again, if we decide that we can build them concurrently, then maybe we don't need to do all this work on the front of the building and whatever if we're not going to need that facility. Again, I think we need to look at all the buildings together and see how they impact each other. And that's my position.
All right, I think the manager wants to respond to one of these.
Yeah, just a brief comment. The suggestion is to delay for 30 days while we look at community services in the kindergarten. The school board as a policy has not made a determination as to where the kindergarten is going. That decision, some of you attended the superintendent of schools session over at Keeley's a couple weeks ago, the long-term strategic planning. I know Councillor Swift-Kiata was at it, and just Councillor Swift-Kiata. And the superintendent indicated they're in a year-long planning process looking at major strategic issues. So, you know, if you were to, you know, not approve this tonight, you're probably looking, for the reasons that you've stated, you're probably looking at a delay in making a decision probably in excess of a year rather than 30 days, because that's how long it will take to get those answers from the school department.
Manager McGovern,
Councillor Roberts, I called on.
Thank you, Madam Chairman. It's time to get this moving off dead center. The committee put a ton of work into this. They've made their recommendations. We debated in workshop last month, or earlier this month, whenever it was, and it was consensus at that time that the police station was designed the way it should be, where it should be. For $1.15, if that figure is correct, we're getting a huge package of new facilities, and the cost is going to go down over time. I'm ready to vote on it and just say, let's do it and do it right and get on with it.
Well, we can continue our discussion. There is no motion, however, at this time on the floor. So if anybody wants to make a motion, or it would be good, and we can continue our discussion.
Had you made one?
I withdraw whatever motion I had, and let's see what comes out on the table.
All right. Yes, Councilor McGee.
You know, it's been the mantra of the committee that we're doing this for 50 years. And I don't think that delaying this for a month or two to take a look at the impact that this project will have on the town center is that big of a deal for looking at a 50-year project. You know, I want to get it done right, and I want to get it done for the best cost possible. Some issues have been raised. I disagree with the town manager when he says we're looking at another year. I'm looking for a month. The only reason I say 2 months is because of the holiday season. That's the only reason I'd say that. I'd say a month otherwise. But to sit down and hash out these issues and see if, in fact, the community services issue has an impact on these buildings. And, you know, that's where I stand in it. Rather than start spending money when it may not get us where we want to be in totality with all the services we have to provide to the town, I'd just like to have us sit down and discuss this. And I think in a workshop, it's a more open forum. We can, you know, banter back and forth and have a more lively discussion than we can have here.
Councilor Swift-Kiata.
I would respectfully disagree with Councilor McGinty that this could be done in a month or 2 months, because as our town manager indicated, I was at that all-day planning meeting, strategic planning meeting for the school department. I attended as a parent representative, and at that meeting it was expressed by our new superintendent of schools, Tom Frisella, that this would indeed be a year-long process, and what happens with kindergarten will have an effect on what happens with community services and wherever it has to be located. And my understanding is that the school department and the school board are not going to be coming to any conclusion on those, any final conclusions on those issues within the next month or two. I would not be surprised if it takes a lot longer than that. I happen to be on the Strategic Planning Committee. There's the gang of 21, I call us, that is looking at these issues, and we don't even have a meeting scheduled until after the holidays, so I don't think these issues are going to be reconciled as quickly as you would hope.
Madam Chair, could I either?
Yes.
I don't know if Ann could answer or not. Maybe Mike could answer it. Isn't there some move right now to at least evaluate or analyze putting classrooms in the basement of the 30s building? Where does...
John Ridge, a member of the school board, asked the fire chief a while ago to look to see whether or not the kindergarten could be in the basement of the middle school. I know the answer, but I don't know if it's been communicated to the school board yet. I can say it publicly if you wish, but I'm a little bit concerned in deference to the school board that the superintendent may not have had an opportunity to inform them on, as to what's in bed. But yes, that is being looked at.
Just to so that everybody knows where I stand, I am completely in favor of moving forward with the Facilities 2000 plan as that we've had on the line here for quite some time. And I have to assume that the Facilities 2000 committee have looked strongly. When Councilor McGinty talks about the town center plan, I'm quite sure that they've looked at the town center and how this plan fits in. So I just wanted to set myself up for exactly how that is. Could I have just a show of hands? Is everybody here that's here now is here for this issue? Mostly. Well, I have the right as the chair to do this, and I think if anybody has any public comment on this time, since we are at the midst of a discussion and we are prior to voting, if there's anybody that can reflect on any of the concerns that the councilors have, or could give us any, or was willing to, would like to give us any comments, I certainly would be happy to entertain them. This is not, however, a public hearing. I am just allowing public comments. Yes.
My name is Kevin Guimond. I live on Ocean House Road. I'm also a firefighter paramedic lieutenant in South Portland, and I sat on a committee to build the dispatch center down there, and I'm now on the committee to build a station at the west end that we need down by the main mall. I share some of Councilor McGinney's concerns. However, I feel the longer we wait, we ran into problems in South Portland with the cost of them going up, with bid prices, buildings, et cetera. I think you bring some valid concerns to the table. I think a lot of the committees have talked about it. I don't want to spend 35 cents more than we have to, but at the same time, I don't want to be back here in a year the way construction costs are with the contractors nowadays. And I think this is part of an overall process where I hope the town heads in the next 10 or 15 years, if you look long term, that we're going to be talking about staffing issues, et cetera, and the buildings we currently have just won't support that. And I think it's probably time to move on. Although I share some of John's concerns, we went through it with the dispatch center in South Portland. It got defeated at referendum. We waited, a year and a half, and the prices went up. And I think if you called the city manager down there, Jeff Jordan, and asked him if he wished it had gone through the first time, he probably would have said yes. The main mall, we have another problem. We're fortunate out here. We own the land. In South Portland, we're trying to buy a piece of land at the mall, as Councilor Roberts knows. The prices of land at the mall is astronomical. We own the land. We're very fortunate, and I think we have a unique situation out here, and I hope to take advantage of it. So I don't think all of what Councilman McGinn is wrong, though. I think he brings up some good concerns, and I'm glad somebody up here has some fiscal responsibility and thinks about it now and then, because you have to. It's not just rush forward. And I don't think the committee did that to you. I think they gave it some good thought. So thanks.
Thank you very much.
I'd like to make it clear, I'm not asking for a year postponement here. I'm asking for 30 or 60 days, that's all.
I know. Any other comments? Fine. It was just a gesture of goodwill. We'll move forward here. Councilor Swift-Gatta.
If there's no other discussion, I'd like to make a motion. Mm-hmm. I'd like to move that we the council, approve the concept plan for improvements to public safety facilities.
Do I have to read that?
And also to authorize funds for design and permitting. I can read the whole draft motion if that would
I think probably given the situation, could you read the draft motion,
certainly,
please?
Okay. The Cape Elizabeth Town Council, the motion that I'm making is the Cape Elizabeth Town Council hereby approves the concept plan proposed by the Facilities 2000 Building Committee as contained in a report entitled Preliminary Design Report for the construction of fire and police facilities, submitted on behalf of the committee by West...
Oast.
Oast, excuse me. Thank you. Associates, and dated November 1999. The town council further authorizes the expenditure of $235,690 for surveying, architectural design, engineering, permitting, specification preparation, construction cost estimating, bidding assistance, and construction oversight of the project, with the funds to be advanced as expenditures as needed, I presume, and with permanent funding to be provided by a future bond issue. The town council authorizes the town manager to assign all contracts required for the project, provided such contracts are within the funding being provided at this time. The town council further authorizes the town manager to apply for all required permits and approvals necessary for the project to proceed. We also wish to thank the Facilities 2000 Committee, town staff, and Oast Associates for their assistance to date on this project.
Second.
I just needed to ask the motioner, not sure if that's a word, that there is a draft motion for the other part, which we could put together, if that is the desire. It's on the third page in, for the $150,000, if you'd like to make that part of that or not.
Sure.
It's on the third
page. I would add, the Cape Elizabeth Town Council hereby authorizes the expenditure of up to $150,000 with the funds to be provided from a future bond issue for the purpose of placing an addition on the front of the Public Works garage, for transferring communications equipment and related expenses, and for transitional expenses relating to temporary relocations during the upcoming construction of a new police station and the renovation of the Public Works garage.
I'll second that as well.
Thank you. Now, discussion. Councilor Fritz.
Just to weigh in, because I hadn't really done that before. I've attended practically all of the Facilities 2000 committee meetings and have been very impressed with the thoroughness, I think, that they have gone through this design and the need. And I particularly, it was made clear to me the need for the public safety building to be renovated when I first came on the council and had a tour of the facility. And I must say, the conditions are really extremely bad there, and there really is a need. So I am going to support this, but I have lots of reservations about, say, the whole community services, the teen center, and community services, and exploring that a lot before we spend any money on that issue. I don't think they ought to be mixed up together, because I think we've proceeded for a long time on this public safety issue, and it's been put off, and other projects have been put in its way for a long time.
Thank you. Councilor McGinty.
I too agree. I mean, I'm not here saying that we don't need better facilities. Certainly, I mean, of anybody, I should know, having worked in the police department, we need a better building. That's not the issue. The issue is making sure we get the job done the right way, in consideration of all the other projects we have to do. Would I be out of order to make a motion to table at this point?
Well, there's a motion on the
Can move to table.
You can move to table as right now? Yes, you can.
I'd make that motion to table for to February 1st, let's say.
Second.
There's no discussion on that. All those in favor? Opposed? Set?
No.
Four. Motion to table fails. Any more discussion on the motion on the floor?
I'd like to explain my reasons for voting for table. I don't think 30 days or 35 days after a 16-year plan in progress is a lot. So I would allow that, but I wouldn't want to continue it for a year, and I will support the motion.
Thank you.
The 2000 committee has done a wonderful job. I too have attended many of the meetings, and I think that they've explored everything they could, and I would support the motion.
Thank you. Is there any more discussion on the motion?
Madam Chair.
On the floor, yes.
I would just like to comment that I, too, think that the Facilities 2000 Committee has done an outstanding job. And what they've put before us, I think, represents a lot of hard work and dedication. And I, too, recognize the need to upgrade our fire department and our police department. As my vote will indicate, I just think we need to spend a little bit, 30 or 60 more days, to look at some of these other issues regarding the things we've mentioned tonight.
Fine. Are we ready to move the question? No more discussion? All those in favor of the motion? 3, 4, 5. Opposed? 2. The motion carries. Thank you very much for your very thoughtful discussion on that item. Item number 63. I'll wait a second till these people move out. It's quite a show of support. Item number 63, consideration of a request from the town manager to fund the replacement of vinyl siding on the northerly side of Town Hall, the purchase of a replacement dump truck, the replacement of the main frame and server of the Town Hall computer system, funds to design a minor renovation of the community center, and paving at Cape Elizabeth High School. Manager is on the floor for this.
I'll give it another try. I realize this could be controversial as well, and I appreciate that, but I will be far less strident on this one. I'm not usually as strident as I was on the last issue. I think particularly in the context of the last issue that the council just voted on, and in some of the other issues that came up, and some of the other things that the town may or may not be looking at over the next few years, it's important to be really looking at the issues, looking at the timing of issues, and when it's the best time to do it. Obviously, the best time to do anything is during the budget process and at the time when you're looking at everything else. I understand that, and I understand that'll be the debate, and that's fine. What I've done is come up with a list of things that I think it's important to be done relatively soon, and things that I think everyone would agree in looking at this, knowing that the tax increase, if this is done now, will be able to stay within that 1% for municipal and county, that we begin to look at some of these things and get them done. Let me get through why I chose these particular items. The Town Hall siding, many of you may have noticed that this side out facing the Heffenreffer Cogswell lot over here looks beautiful now. It's been all resided, repainted. The front is a jarring contrast to most of us. When one comes up here, that you see that's still the old vinyl siding, and that's your way. That's due to be done this spring. It would have been done this fall, except our contractor was a cross-country coach, and that was a good high priority for him at the same time. What I'd like to do, though, is when we do the front, it makes sense for contracting to save some money, as well as the continuity, to also do this side over here facing the service station lot, as well as the small piece that is the doorway that's over on this side of the building that actually faces Route 77. The wall that's directly in back of the William H. Jordan Conference Room here has already had the vinyl siding taken off, and that would need to be painted. So this $13,000 would enable us this spring to get that whole side, the whole front, and this side. So anyone going up or down Route 77 will see a completed building instead of one for some time that looks half done. That's that one. The second one is, we recently discovered that our computer company that does all of our accounting, payroll, taxes, assessing, appraisal records, all our most important financial record keeping, is about to move forward with all sorts of software enhancements that are going to be Java-based or GUI, graphical user interface, for those who are into computerese. And anyway, that's fine and that's good. But the difficulty with it is, because they're moving to this whole new platform, they've indicated to us they're not going to be making any changes to the old system, which really puts a squeeze on us. And I don't like it, but I also know we have such a huge investment in all the data with our current system that we're really between a rock and a hard place. Our current computer server, the mainframe, is about 6 years old, which I think everyone realizes in computer time is quite elderly. It has 1 gigabyte of memory. All this GUI stuff, GUI, graphical user interface, requires a lot more than 1 gigabyte of memory. So it really forces us to look at replacing this server before we replace the rest of the software. When you add all that whole project together, it's about $65,000. And I'm proposing we spend the first part now, which is replacing the hardware, and then do the software in next year's budget. There's a dump truck replacement we're looking at again. Last January, the council authorized us to order a dump truck. It still isn't in yet. It took that long to deliver. This one might be in a lot sooner because of apparently South Portland, another community, I already said it, South Portland, ordered some trucks. No, they didn't order some trucks. They did order some trucks, but they ordered it from another vendor. This vendor, one of the vendors that we usually deal with, was pretty sure it was going to go to South Portland, and they didn't do it, so we're having some discussions on a real economical way of buying the truck. Bob knows how economical. Do you? Oh, he doesn't know yet, but it sounds a lot more economical. Anyway, Bob goes into some dialogue here. I won't repeat it. I'm sure you've all read it, but the point is you save money by replacing. I don't agree with Bob. We ought to be moving to a 10-year replacement schedule right away. And even what he's proposing here is still on a 15-year schedule, so we're not really getting too far ahead. As has been just discussed, we're looking at the community center, not community services, the community center, in terms of beginning to look at that building to see how it might be renovated, see how we could better meet some of the needs of the teens and the seniors in the shorter term, because of, you know, we're looking at a lot of expenses and proposing $15,000 to really begin to look at low-cost solutions to that building. We might spend far less than that if we find out initially it's just not going to work for some reason, because we don't want to spend any nickel more than we have to, but $15,000 would see it through to actually coming up with a plan if all goes well. The high school driveway and parking lot, that has not been paved in quite some time. Ernie and Bob worked together, and Ernie McVeigh and Bob Malley are coming up with a proposal to pave all the parking lots, to pave the roads. Ended up $91,000. So anyway, proposing $45,000 at this point. You add all that up, it's $200,000. You look at that in the context of the draft thus far of the capital improvement plan. This doesn't include the school portion, but I understand the school portion is going to be a little bit down from last year, I'm due to receive it after the school board meeting tomorrow. But you look at it, and next year's projections add up to about $890,000 capital improvement needs. This year we spent $675,000. If we advance fund this $200,000, it gets this down to $689,000. And that enables us to live a lot better within that $175,000 overall increase in paying for everything. Because that's where this would come out of, that $175,000. If we spent this $200,000, we'd start off $25,000 in the hole in order to keep within that 1% target. I realize this is a stretch, and I debated asking for it, but you know, as I said here, what did I say? I thought it was, it will enable us to continue to maintain our facilities and to replace equipment with a reasonable replacement schedule. While the project is varied, each ensures the quality services will continue to be able to provide it to citizens and will maintain the investments that citizens have made in the past. You know, I've done an awful lot of other projections I didn't go over here. The funds are available. People still continue to buy cars. Their investment earnings have been better. But I think, you know, this really enables us to continue to keep our balance sheet fiscally sound and to accomplish some projects that need to be accomplished and get them done a little bit earlier than we might otherwise do. Thank you, Madam Chairman.
Councilor Roberts.
I had a number of questions on this, and I guess I'll just go through them page by page. Mm-hmm. With the dump truck, and we have a capital reserve program, are we setting money aside each year to purchase vehicles and other major items as they come due? And if we are, why do we need the full amount to buy the truck, and why isn't a good percentage of that already there?
To answer your questions, we don't have a capital reserve, and we try to avoid bonding for equipment because we're already bonding so much other money for the big projects. So we don't have capital reserves. One opportunity we have, which I doubt we do, is, you know, as I was looking at that, you always look at when do you begin to establish those reserves. The council has indicated at times they'd like to choose to. We've done a little bit with the fire, but then they went out because I got behind and borrowed the money, so it really isn't a reserve anymore. We remember the truck was rusting. You know, the opportunity to do that, if we ever want to get on that reserve system, is when that debt service begins to go down, is to try to capture some of those few pennies each year, and that would help to set up reserve, but we just don't have it now.
The other question that I had was in regards to the high school driveway, and I have been complaining about that driveway. One means of egress out of there. Is any of this money available to study where we could get a second way in and out?
No, this was simply just for paving. Our plan was to start at the back, at the upper and lower parking lots down by the pool, and then to pave the driveway coming up to up past the tennis courts. There's no funds for looking at this, and there's also we talked about, you know, we'd really like to put some better parking in at the tennis courts, in order, because the students park illegally because they don't have places to park, and others. So we're looking at expanding, but this doesn't do that, Jack.
And my final comment was, if this money is available, and we had cut the school department earlier in their budget, have we looked at their needs to see if maybe we could be doing something similar with them and splitting this extra funds?
Splitting the cost of the school?
Splitting that benefit, yeah.
That's why, Counselor, you know, they were a little surprised when I mentioned to them, they had gotten the estimate for the $91,000 for the high school. They were very surprised, I think, at least at the staff level, when I said, you know, we take care of the grounds, we should really fund that on the municipal. So we are, in fact, relieving them of some of that burden, because that they were surprised.
Is that something that we would normally do anyway?
And the one-time concept, yes.
The issue hasn't come up with paving before, you know, because it just hasn't been done in so long. And I just, you know, that's what, when I spoke with Paulina Portrait, the school business manager, she was getting ready to put it in the school CIP and was surprised that when I indicated that we'd try to do it through the town CIP.
I guess finally, wouldn't it not be better to put this into the regular budget process and let it sink or swim on its own merit for 6 months?
That's the debate.
Councilor McGinty. Councilor Roberts, are you done for right now?
I'm finished, thank you.
First, I'd like to direct a comment through the chair, obviously, towards Jack, and that is, you know, that driveway, maybe if we had a master plan for the town center, it's an issue we could have looked at. Now back to and Jack kind of hit on it. I would say that for all these issues, I don't see anything here as an emergency. I personally don't like to appropriate money outside of, except on an emergency basis, for capital or virtually anything else for that matter, outside of the regular budget process, because as Jack said, and I was going to say for all these, that, you know, they're not competing with the other issues that we face from all departments on all the other issues that can be raised in a regular budget process. These are kind of given to us in a sterile manner, and, you know, it's look at it, and we got the money. I always, you know, the undesignated surplus, I don't think is there necessarily to fund ongoing CIP projects. It's there for emergencies. And unless I'm convinced one of these is an emergency, I won't be supporting this. I also have a question for the town manager, if I may, on the town hall computer replacement. We appropriated $20,000 in the budget for computers.
That's right.
What happened to that money?
The $20,000 that you appropriated in the budget was for computer upgrades throughout the town, for, you know, all PCs, all computers. This past week, for example, I got a new PC because my computer was not Y2K compatible. Debbie got a new computer because her computer was not Y2K compatible. There's been a number of those types of issues during the year that we've had to address because of Y2K compatibility. Beyond that, it was, you know, a host of different odds and ends, for everything from printers to it was mainly that. You know, if I needed a fallback position on this one, which I might need, you know, I do think it makes economic sense for us to get one price to do all of the siding on the front and on the side at the same time. That is a project that's already half funded in the current year's budget. And the other ones, you know, if they are separate, distinct projects that could be funded in next year's budget alone, but that is one that I just think it really makes sense to do it as one project It's also the least expensive one on the list.
As far as the computers, I mean, are we going to be out of business if we don't? I mean, if anyone looks to me like it's urgent, that the way you phrase this, at least, that looks like it may be.
What the difference is they're going to start introducing these enhancements in April. We will not be able to take advantage of any of these enhancements in April, and then we're looking in next year's budget at a $65,000 issue for both the enhancements, software and the hardware. And I was just looking to get the hardware up and running, to have it working. And, you know, in the community center one, that's, you know, the committee's asked for the money. But I, you know, Bob's looking out there, why aren't you defending my truck?
That's the
point. But I do think the siding's important. And, yeah, the computer, it's just a case we're not going to have those enhancements. And, you know, the real danger is over the longer term. You know, I can't say there's a danger between April and July that, you know, something's going to go wrong, that we need enhancement. In the longer term, you know, I don't want to be on a system that our computer supplier won't provide enhancements for, because you have something go wrong in payroll, and, you know, you're not in good shape.
If I could, oh, I'm sorry.
Councilor Roberts.
If I might, the computer one I could definitely support, because we're not talking July. If that budget's not approved, it has to go out to bid, it has to be competitive bid, put in before you get it up and going. We're talking probably November, December before it's actually in place at that rate. So that one, I think, for all practical reasons, needs to be moved on. Mm-hmm. And the others, if somebody wants to make a case for them, I'm...
The siding and the community services?
I merely commented. That mean I wouldn't vote for them if somebody doesn't give me a good reason why I should.
Maybe if I could suggest something on, you know, you can vote no on all of them, but maybe if you voted on each one,
I think we'll vote individually on these. Councilor Swift-Cayetta had a...
I was just going to pick up on Councilor McGinty's question about what will happen if these are not done. I happen to be in the awkward position of having not noticed that the siding was jarringly bad on the front. I mentioned that to Mr. McGovern this morning, and he was shocked that I had not even noticed, so I'm obviously out of it. I would agree with Councilor Roberts that the only one that seems that it has potential for risk if we delay is the computer one. I have been in the position where suddenly I've been using a system that is not supported, and you sort of live in fear that something may go wrong and you won't be able to get anybody to help. So that one I can definitely support as sort of an emergency kind of measure. But I would be willing to listen to other ones.
Madam yes. Chair, my view on this is that I think Michael makes a great point about the siding. Does it make sense to have one price and do it as much of it as we can now since we have the surplus? I agree that the computer probably needs to be upgraded because if you can't upgrade it, because if they won't support it, I don't know what good it is for you. The dump truck, Bob, you probably need to address that, but I would suggest that maybe that does go into next year's budget, although Bob, you could persuade me. Regarding the community center design, we currently have $5,000 that we didn't spend that the town council allocated to us to use for our findings, which we have not used. Technically, if we had another $5,000 or $10,000, it would help us move forward with our plans. Not getting this money will mean that we will have to come before the council to get an extension to our six-month report. We will not have the information we need to make a recommendation. So if we do not get this money, we will not be able to make a recommendation to the council. It will push this project to the recommendation stage, probably off until September, I would anticipate. So we do have $5,000 that was advanced to us. I think if we had another five, maybe not 10, but another five, that would certainly help us investigate this problem. And as it relates to the Community Center Study Committee, since I am the chair of that, what we're looking at is a building that we bonded. We're carrying, what, $60,000 the next couple of years to pay that building off, and yet the space is very limited because of the number of people that you can have congregate in any one room. And Sue Weatherby has been working with us on this committee in an ad hoc basis, and from a standpoint of senior programming and adult programming during the daytime, if some walls were taken down on 1226 Shore Road, it would be a lot better utilization. Also, if we looked at changing the charter and started renting out that space to some organizations, we could generate some revenue. And if we expand or if we do some moderate renovations to the basement, we can turn that into a game room. And those are the kinds of things, particularly the basement is a question, and that's why we need to hire a design team and some people to come in and look at it, because we're not sure that it will pass the proper OSHA codes. The state fire marshal was in and looked at the building, and it appears that we can put an exit or egress out through the bulkhead, but there is some question as to whether the height of the ceiling is high enough for us to allow any number of people to congregate down there. So without that information, it's very hard for the committee to progress in terms of making a recommendation. So therefore, I would support some additional funds going to that. The high school driveway and parking lot, I would support this because we've spent all this money on our pool. We've got this great, wonderful pool that's going to be opening, and we have a driveway that's full of potholes and is not wonderful. So I would suggest we spend the $45,000 and fix the driveway. Mm-hmm. And Bob, I'd love to hear what you have to say about the dump truck.
The main plug I'd make for the dump truck is, many of you when you were campaigning in the past have heard me talk about the importance of maintaining equipment replacement schedules over the years, and Mike and I have talked about the length of time we keep them. And the problem is, from year 10 to year 15, we put a lot of money into these units, and they take a lot of abuse. And as I said in the memo, imagine keeping your own vehicle that long and what you have to do for maintenance, or it costs a lot of money. And if you approve the truck tonight, it means we could get it as early as a month, or it could be as early as June or July. If you don't, and it's part of the regular budget process, we probably wouldn't receive the truck till next October or November. And my fear is that if there's major problems with the truck, if there's transmission issues or whatever, that if we have to sink another $1,000 into this truck, you know, it's just not worth it. And we've put over $18,000 into the truck right now. It's really had a hard life. It's been used as a salt unit for many years. It's a 1984. It's been used very hard. So you're going to see it in 2 months if you don't approve it tonight during the regular budget process. So we'll be making the same arguments then. But we're trying to take the curse out of the five-year plan. There's another large piece of equipment that you'll see in that. And it's just, you know, we've got a large fleet of rolling stock over there and the largest in the town that we need to maintain and take care of. And we just need to replace these things on a timely basis. And we've had to do this before. We might have been good about supporting these requests outside the budget process and along with the council. And we do appreciate that. But the problem's not going to go away. And I'd hate to have to sink more money into the engine or transmission if it needed it.
Councilor Fritz.
I guess there's maybe only one of these items that even comes close to looking like an emergency kind of designation, because I really do think we should be doing this during the budget process, and I don't think the undesignated surplus is there to spend and expand the budget. I think that if anything, it should reduce our need to increase the budget for next year. So I really don't think we ought to be looking to spend it on things that aren't emergency. But the computer system, I mean, I'm hoping that yours and Deborah's computers are, your new ones would be, is that in addition? I mean, this is in addition to yours, and I guess I'm really surprised you're just now getting computers that are Y2K.
No, we had known quite some time ago, but we tried to save money by getting them through the school department, which was fine. I think we did. We get on the same Micron platform that they're on. And that's, you know, we didn't have any fears. Gary knew when they were going to come in. It's mm-hmm. And it wasn't a major. It was an issue with the BIOS, BIOS. It wasn't, you know, a major issue, but I didn't want to be in the position of losing everything and then saying I knew it was a Y2K problem and I didn't deal with it. So, but it's we weren't too worried about that.
Yeah.
We knew we were going to have it by December 31.
On the siding, I mean, I really do like what the finished side looks like. It looks great, but it still doesn't seem like an emergency kind of situation to continue that. And I mean, the community center spending money on that. I really want to hear the analysis of the other buildings, and because I haven't been convinced yet that there's even a need to do anything to the community center, or that it's appropriate for a teen center or anything like that. So I really couldn't support putting money into that at this point.
Okay, Councilor Roberts.
I don't want to let Bob get out of here without answering at least a few questions. In your comments, you indicated that the truck that you wanted to get will not be doing salting like this one had been doing?
It will be a truck with a sander body on it, but it won't be one of our salting units. We have three units that we salt right now, but it'll have a sander body on. We currently salt with three units and sand with four, so it will have a body to do sand. It can be used for salting, too. So it's
we also, what happens to your operation if that truck goes down? Are you crippled or during the time?
It puts us down one unit. Right now, we don't have a spare unit at all until our other truck gets here, which will be in 2 weeks. So this allows us to have a spare unit, and it also allows us to have a truck to start a salt run while we're still plowing, which is something we have to do occasionally to beat the weather element. So it's not like the truck just sits in the garage all the time as a spare unit. It is used during our heavy item pickups. It's used for a number of projects during the year.
For what it's worth, I like your idea of a 10-year replacement schedule. But
we just find we put a lot of money in after that 10-year period. That's when the maintenance expenses really add up a lot.
And Swift Ada.
This isn't really a question for Mr. O'Malley, but I just wanted to say before I would want to make any decision about going from 15 years to 10 years for a useful life for a truck or any other piece of equipment, I'd want to see some numbers. Not that I don't trust you, but I just want to see some numbers to see how those trade-offs work so that we could see if there would be some different break-even point. I know we're not making a decision on that now, but I would want to see some numbers before we...
Bob, you have pretty comprehensive numbers and all this.
Just if I might, this replacement is based on 15 years. It's not based on 10. I would not...
Yes, I
understand. If he had asked for a 10-year, I wouldn't have chanced it.
No, that was clear.
Would
you entertain a motion at this point? Are we ready to move forward on this?
Yes, I had suggested that we try and take them up separately in an effort to get to the variety of opinions, but...
Yeah, well, I was going to move approval of the computer replacement for $30,000.
Hmm? Second.
Okay. Now, I just need to make clear. That's just one motion, okay? We're just going to do that. All right. All those in favor?
Computer.
Oh, we're just doing the computer. Okay.
We're just doing that one item.
All right.
Is that up to 30,000?
Yes. All right.
I make a motion. Can I do this?
Yes.
Make a motion that we expend up to 13,000 to do the town hall siding.
Any more discussion? Oh, second.
I second. Thank you.
Any more discussion? All those in favor? Guess that's why I seconded it, huh? Seemed like it was a good economy of scale to have the guy continue all the way around.
Were you supporting it, John? I saw your hand go up. Were you supporting it?
All
right.
Madam Chair, make a motion that we advance another $5,000 to the Community Center Study Committee for to come up with some engineering and design for the renovation of that building.
Could I ask you, since you're on that committee and I've only been to that one meeting,
yes,
do you think that the five that you have in 5 years would be enough? Would that really tie your hands in finding out all the information you need for the downstairs, the upstairs, the doorway? You think, since he's recommended 15, do you think five from here would be enough?
I was forgetting about the five. I think 10 more.
10 more would have to
be. Yeah, I was afraid you might be cutting.
Okay, so you think we have to do, you really think we need an additional 10 with our five?
If we find that it looks like a go, yeah.
I'll second it.
I amend it to say 10,000.
Okay.
Second the 10.
Moved and seconded. Any more discussion? Councilor McGinty.
I have a concern. You know, I haven't seen a report from this committee. I mean, we're spending money on engineering design I mean, this kind of goes, well, I mean, at least with the Facilities 2000, we saw our plan.
Whether you like it or not, you're right.
I feel like I'm reacting to something that I have no idea what's out there.
These are the guys who are going to make the plan.
Yes. I don't think we can conclude, I'm on that committee, and I don't think we can conclude what we want to recommend until we need some professional advice as to whether that building would even be appropriate. And then, depending upon whether we find out whether or not it could even work, then we can make some recommendations.
Well, maybe I'm confused by the wording of that, because that's not what it says. It says we fund the necessary engineering design of a renovation program. That's not what you're asking for, then.
We are looking for the money to hire a professional design team to come in and look at the building and evaluate all the OSHA requirements that we'd have to do to meet to see if that building is even feasible. I'll take it as our committee's report, just our consensus, if you will, one step farther to say that we feel that if we are to move forward with a community center, that the only way for us to do it is to take an existing building like 1226, make some renovations that even if this whole community center doesn't happen, will be a building that could be better utilized by the town by making those renovations. And our feeling is that if we can't renovate this building, and I'm speaking for a lot of people here, you have to understand, is that at this current juncture, we probably cannot support a community center, because we'd be talking probably about renovating that building to the tune of $1 or $2 million. That is not feasible with all the capital improvement projects we're looking at. The only real feasibility project that we have is if this community center on 1226 will work for a renovation. That makes sense to us to recommend. If that doesn't fly, if the design people come back and say you can't renovate this building for the uses that you want to use it for, then I think we're dead in the water. That I really think that's where we are. Because nobody on the committee is ready to come forward and make a recommendation to the council to spend $1 or $2 million currently. But if we could, if it were feasible to renovate that building for a total of about $50,000, that's something that we feel our programs would support if we change the charter, which allows us to rent out that space. We can generate some revenue, but also have it used for some other, for senior programming, adult program during the day, some after-school programming for teens, and a weekend opening for teens, but also rentals for birthday parties, etc. So those are the kinds of things we're looking at.
I actually went on the tour just before that meeting. The potential is very great for that building. Considering the amount of use that the building gets now for community services, for seniors or for anybody that participates in any of the classes that are held there, if we could find out if the walls could be adjusted, a lolly column instead of a wall makes a big difference in making open space. I think the continued use of that building will only grow. We'll find that it's a very useful part of our community. It's heavily used now. And to be able to make that space more flexible,
yes,
for those continued uses and any expanded uses, to me, is maybe money well spent. And as she said, if it's not a go, they'll know that.
Right. Yeah. And then we.
But we, you know, the chance that we can really use that, I mean, because it really has the potential to be used for many other things.
I guess I wish this just came, you know, this comes in kind of the middle of a capital improvement plan here. I wish it'd come maybe from the committee itself directly and said, you know, this is what we need the money for, rather than to put through.
I think it sort of did. It kind of
sticks out here, the capital improvement. Everything else here is a capital improvement, with the exception of this item. So it kind of.
Well, we could consider it separately, but I think it was the unanimous consensus of the committee that we wanted to put this forward.
I will support this now that it's been explained. But like I say, the way it came, it should have came a different channel. But I'll support this.
Move the question. I'll withdraw.
He withdrew it, Henry, so that you could ask your question.
I just wonder if the committee has checked with any consultants to get an idea of what it might run, doing the job that they want to be done.
Well, this is actually what they hope to get out of this additional money here.
Yeah, consultant I plan to use, since this is just a small project, is one that's already quite familiar with the building, quite familiar with the project. He's indicated that his feeling is that there's some code issues that need to be looked at very early, and that, you know, we're probably talking a small amount of money if those code issues appear to be insurmountable. If they're not insurmountable, and, you know, what the major issue, we had the state fire marshal over there last week sometime, and he looked at the basement, and the big issue was he said it could be used, but he wasn't looking at ADA. And the issue, and, you know, what would really begin to get in with design is, you know, what would it actually cost to make that ADA accessible? And that portion of estimating, designing, figuring out how it could be made ADA accessible, as well as having an overall schematic, that's where you run into the additional dollars beyond just the initial, so that when the committee made its report, it could say this works or it doesn't.
I mean, it could be a very short report if this building doesn't work.
Is that what the committee feels is about what the consultant is going to charge?
I have to defer to Michael.
Manager.
I think my read of it is, you know, the 15,000 foot, I tried to put it high enough so that we would not come back and ask for more money if, as we continued to study, they wanted to do a little bit more. Well, what if we did this? What if we did that? Should be, it is more than enough. Based on my preliminary, you know, the consultant I plan to use is very familiar with the discussions in the committee.
All right. Well, then I think the amount appropriated, if the council votes to appropriate it, should be up to $10,000.
Yeah, well, we already have a motion on the floor for this. Councilor Fritz, are you part of, are you going to, on this discussion of this item? Okay.
Right. Again, I still think we need to hear, it doesn't seem like there's a rush on this item, and I'd like to hear from the committee, I guess, the analysis of our other facilities. I mean, I don't know that turning this over to a teen center after school is a good idea, or whether there couldn't be a use of the school facility itself for something, putting up a gate so that it was not, the whole thing was not available. I want to hear some ideas first before we go spending money on this facility, on the analysis of our other facilities in the town. What we
see, I don't see this. I'm not looking at this as the teen center.
No.
I'm really looking at this as part of the community services, community use.
Yes.
The teen center, when we went down to the basement, we looked at it, we said, wow, this could really work. You know, they were saying this could really work as a teen center. I looked at what we were looking at upstairs as the use for the community services and the kind of uses that it has, that you're limited on the one main meeting room because it only hosts X number of people, but there are 20 more people who want to take whatever the course was that was being held by community services, and if we could eliminate the wall, put up two columns, we could accommodate those people.
But see, I want to hear that analysis, I guess, of what our current programs are now.
In that building, you mean?
And what additional, what are the problems? What are the constraints?
It's not big enough.
Yeah.
But the walls were there. I mean, they're asking for a very simple thing, and that is the building is already in use, and not just for community services.
Oh.
For any other meetings, there's some constraint because of the size. So we say, well, this room could be double the size if we could move that wall. Well, we don't know if we can move that wall because we needed to spend the money. But we know the room is already being used and would be used more. So,
but yeah. I guess yeah. If you need a bigger room for something, are there other bigger rooms in the town that could be used? I haven't heard that.
Right.
And I don't know that we should be discussing.
Yeah. Okay.
You know, I think we need to have a workshop and that there's not a big hurry.
Well, there is a motion on the floor for this, and I'm ready to move the question. Are you through with it? Yeah, I'm ready to move the question.
Could we just repeat the motion? Just
right.
Motion is to expend up to $10,000 to the Community Center Study Committee for meeting building feasibility. Sorry.
Okay, that's been moved and seconded. All those in favor? Opposed? One. Well, we're knocking these things off here one at a time.
Madam Chair.
Yes.
I move that we support the high school driveway and parking lot paving to the tune of up to $45,000. No seconds.
I think it fails for lack of a second.
Me too.
All right. We have just one item left.
Was that the dump truck? Oh,
we're
yes.
on the dump truck.
Madam Chair.
Yes.
I once again move that we advance the funds to replace the 19A board dump truck to the tune of up to $97,000, and it is to replace it with a single axle truck with a plow and a wing.
Great experience to ride that wingman on one of those plows. I hope we get the truck and get to do it.
Oh, that'd be great.
If it's going to plow.
That's it, I think. Is that it?
I'll second it.
It's been moved and seconded. Is there any further discussion on the dump truck? Are you for discussion or voting?
For discussion. Oh. I just want to know, as much as I support the Public Works Department, and I really do, again, I don't believe this is an immediate emergency. And you know, I think it can be handled in the regular budget process. You know, if the transmission falls out, I guess we'll have to deal with it.
Councilor Barry.
I'd just like a quick question for Bob O'Malley, if you could tell me, why does this cost so much?
They're just very expensive. The trucks themselves are right around $48,000, $50,000 just for the chassis alone. The dump body is, sander body is another 16,000, plow equipment's 18 to 20.
I see, you put it all together.
It's all one big package.
Right? And have you put this out to bid?
Not yet. No. Waiting for your approval tonight.
I see.
Hey, Fred.
Any further discussion? Yes.
I'm looking for some snow, so maybe if we get the truck, we'll be ready for it.
Yes.
And then maybe we won't get it.
Everybody will want to turn in the wing. All right. I'm going to move the question. All those in favor of the purchase of the dump truck replacement? 3-4
Do we have, what do we have, 3?
Four.
We have four. That's right.
Four.
Get your ride, Bruce.
We have a roll call vote.
All right. Okay. Bob, I'm looking for that ride when it comes in.
Opposed. Get all those names attached to those hands. The motion carries. My goodness, I think that we're through with that item, whichever item it is. Well, Mr.
Thank
Manager,
you.
I'll
Thank
tell you
much.
Something. I
didn't hurt to ask.
Last week I thought we're gonna win.
Successful.
Okay, a little check mark there. Item number 64. Boy, this will be a good one coming up. Consideration of a report from the Appointments Committee recommending citizens to fill vacancies on town boards and commissions.
Madam Chairman.
Yes.
I move that the Appointments Committee's recommendation be approved to fill vacancies on town boards and commissions.
Second.
There's a second. Councilor Swift-Cayetta. Any more discussion?
Would the Appointments Committee like to make any comment?
Yes. You want to make some comments?
Just a short one. I know we're pressed for time here. I just wanted to, as Chair of the Appointments Committee, I wanted to thank Ruth Watson and Jack Roberts, who are also on the Appointments Committee. We saw many excellent candidates, and I think Cape Elizabeth is lucky to have as many people turn out for these jobs, some of them somewhat thankless, usually. as they are. I want to thank everyone who applied for their time and their willingness to serve the town, because the spirit of volunteerism is something that makes this Cape Elizabeth a great place to live. And I know it sounds corny, but it's true. So you have the list in front of you. Do we have to read?
No.
These lists? Good. I'm glad.
It's been moved and seconded. Seeing no further discussion, all those in favor? Opposed? A unanimous vote.
Is it our first one tonight?
No.
Okay.
My minutes are out of order here, but the next item is consideration of acceptance of gifts given to the town thus far during 1999. And I would like to, but I can't remember where I put. I got it out of order. You got your little list right there, clerk? Just look at that for a second. This is really an extraordinary thing, and I'd like the public to to just be aware, we're not going to read certainly the names and amounts of people, of things that they give, but just the types of things that people in this community voluntarily give to. There's certainly the children's youth programs, soccer programs, Little League, things of that nature. There's also the one of the most extraordinary things that's happened this year is with the centennial celebration of the Fort Williams Advisory Committee, through the recommendation of a citizen, has had several opportunities to have gifts and donations made to the fort. And one of the very successful ones has been for park benches. The benches vary in prices, but if any of you have been fortunate enough to walk on the new cliff walk that was donated by the Barbers, you now will see some very handsome benches donated by several different people to be on the cliff walk as well as in other areas of the fort. The police department and the rescue frequently get donations, and those are there as well. There are several donations from service clubs, including the Rotary and the Lions, some large ones. Things, for instance, the pond, the reconstruction of the pond at the what was it in my day, the fish pond, which is now, I guess, the skating pond at Fort Williams, a large donation. for those types of things, as well as holiday baskets that go out to people in need at the holiday season. This is only a small sampling of the types of gifts that come to this community that are voluntarily given, and to those people and all the others in the past that have given to these types of items to this community, the Town Council heartily thanks you, and we appreciate your efforts and your thoughtfulness to do that. So it is appropriate now for the Council to accept the gifts as already given. Thank you, Councilor McGinty.
I move we accept the gifts as.
I second.
It's the first time, Henry, that you've been fast tonight. You haven't been as fast with the second.
Well, I'm sick.
However, you've made some motions.
I've been doing my best. Could I ask a question?
Yes.
How much does a bench cost at Fort William?
Well, they have a variety of prices. They have concrete granite benches, which are the most. You want to talk about this, Michael?
Yes. We charge a little over double what the bench actually cost. The Fort Williams Committee looked at it, and the thinking is once someone donates a bench, the town owns it, and we're then responsible for its replacement should something happen to it. Mm-hmm. So we really looked at this as you're not only buying the bench, but you're also buying the perpetual care of the bench.
Installation.
And the installation. So that the reason those benches are so high is because the thought is, in the long term, they won't cost the town any funding. They're paying for the initial bench and enough so that they could be replaced if it ever met a sorry fate.
My question was, how much is one?
I don't recall, but I think the granite one was $1,444.
I was going to say about $2,000, I thought.
Yeah, but that didn't include installation. That was simply for the granite, you know, the markings itself. Fort Williams Committee's done most of the work on the Fort Williams Advisory Commission.
We have a wonderful Fort Williams Committee right now. They are really a proactive group.
Right.
And hardworking.
I'd like to ask about the Fields for Kids budget. Is it enough to fund all the projects that are proposed for Fields for Kids?
Yeah, the Fields for Kids project funded the additional Little League field at Lions Field and the big multi-purpose field at Fort Williams. Provided the Little League and the soccer group follow through on their pledges, which, as you can see, they have this year, that is fully funded, yes.
All those in favor? Opposed? Thank you very much. Are there any items not on the agenda that's for citizens' discussion?
Madam Chair, may I just announce that the Town Council Ordinance Committee will be meeting this Wednesday, the 15th at 4 o'clock in the afternoon in the planning offices. And we're going to be discussing ordinances on loosening the variance requirements and also the tower, the communication tower ordinance.
Thank you. I have a motion to adjourn.
I'm going to adjourn.
Second.
Been moved and seconded. All those in favor? Thank you. No opposed. So we can